As we prepare to begin in the next 15 minutes, I would appreciate that the sisters sit on the right and the brothers on the left. The right of the stage, females, on the left of the stage, males, please. Jazakallah. My right, your left. Just give me a few minutes.
No problem.
I'll give you a short interview now. You be ready for me, I'm coming.
Four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10.
I'm Nazir, how are you? And Nazir, you make that Wali guys meet at 3 o'clock, is it okay? Wali, no. The Wali, Robert Chef. Yeah. You know who it is. You know, on the corner of Diagonal and Presidency, Ibrahim London and his partner. Yeah, the partner. Daud's father. Yeah. All right. Yeah. This thing told me last night, Yunus, this thing Shabir Kaji told me Fajr time, that he's passed away days ago. A month ago. Is 3 o'clock is okay?
Come on.
All right. Which one? From Robert Chef.
All right.
So let's do it together. Just arrange with them for the janaza namaz. I'm making the janaza namaz of that wali bhai. If they allow me, yeah. Call me back.
We don't take the video unless it's question and question.
Okay.
We don't just know it.
One. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu ta'ala. To all of those who love Hajj, who are interested in Hajj and who have the intention of doing Hajj, whether it be in the year 1437 or onwards, welcome to the South African Hajj and Umrah Council Hajj Awareness Day program taking place here at Image Lifestyle Center in Fordsburg, Johannesburg. Alhamdulillah, this is the first of three Hajj awareness programs. The first one kicking off in Gauteng, the next one hopefully to be in another region of the country, and the remaining two regions would be both KwaZulu-Natal, taking place in Durban, as well as Cape Town in the Western Cape. These Hajj awareness seminars serve as a means of being able to give insight for prospective Hujjaj in terms of what to expect and how to gear themselves up for Hajj. The excitement here is building, alhamdulillah, exhilarating, with every Muslim's hairs standing on end. Reason being that, subhanAllah, this kicks off the Hajj season for the year 1437 in this part of the country. One's mind should be going to every other part of the world, because what would be happening? Similarly, like this, there would be programs in different parts of the world where, subhanAllah, people would be preparing for the journey of Hajj. While it may be a good 4, 5, or 6 months away, this is the time when one starts reciting the talbiyah. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. Inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika laka. Oh Allah, I am present. Oh Allah, I am present. Oh Allah, there is no partners for you. Oh Allah, I am presenting myself before you. SubhanAllah, the war cry of Hajj. One commences reciting this and chanting this right now. When you awake, when you're about to retire to bed, when you're ascending, when you're descending, when you board a means of conveyance, when you're sitting and waiting for that next meeting or that next appointment or the next class, at every opportunity, one seizes the time to recite the talbiyah. And even if you haven't yet made the intention of Hajj and you're tuning in for this live stream from Image Lifestyle Center for SAUK's Hajj Awareness Program, subhanAllah, it's time for you to start reciting the talbiyah, because then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make sure that all of His creation bear testimony to you reciting this talbiyah, and inshallah, that invitation will be awarded to you sooner than you can think. What does a Hajj Awareness Day have in store for you? How is Hajj Awareness Day in store, subhanAllah, has in store for all of those who are tuning in and many who are participating and attending live in this particular function? The Hajj Awareness Day presents you with the opportunity of having an insight into the logistical and administrative arrangements that are a necessary part of Hajj. We know that in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and in the era thereafter, it was perhaps a bit simpler in terms of logistics and administration, but there was always that element of spiritual preparation. That stays, perhaps is more important in this day, this age, and this time. But these are necessary prerequisites to make sure that, subhanAllah, you are well catered for when you reach the lands of Wahi and Revelation, the lands of Makkah al-Mukarramah and the lands of Madinah al-Munawwara. These two beloved, illuminated cities that are filled with nur and anwar and blessings. When you have the opportunity of reaching there, subhanAllah, you should be fully prepared mentally, spiritually, emotionally, psychologically, and subhanAllah, most importantly, you should be ready to present yourself towards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The opportunity of embarking on this journey is not the day one sets foot on a plane, but indeed, this initiative and experience and lifelong journey and experience of Hajj commences right now. So while the atmosphere is one that continues to build and people are exhilarated and waiting, subhanAllah, for the Hajj Awareness Day, the first of three Hajj Awareness Days to kick off here in Johannesburg, Fordsburg, at the Image Lifestyle Center, we ask of you to stay tuned, for inshallah, in a few minutes, the program will commence. Many of the tour operators have presented themselves here today and have little stalls where they're presenting their offerings to prospective Hujjaj, other interested parties who also share services and who provide services for Hujjaj, like investment wings, some of the banking windows, Islamic banking windows that have Hajj programs and Hajj schemes so that people can save for Hajj are also here on this particular day. As we can hear in the background, the program is about to commence. We are a few seconds before 9:30. We ask of you to stay tuned and inshallah, watch this particular live stream of South African Hajj and Umrah Council's Hajj Awareness Day, so that inshallah, inshallah, thumma inshallah, that inkling, that flame in your heart to undertake this journey of Hajj can be rekindled, so that inshallah, you are ready and prepared when the time presents itself and when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summons you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May we please settle down. All the Hujjaj Kiram that are with the agents, can you please settle down? We've got a minute. We will ask the agents. You will have a lot of time, ample time to interact with the Hujjaj. Can we settle down and in the next minute or two, we want to start our program. Please. Brother Shaheen, Maulana Muhammad Vaid, Brother Ismail Kulwadia, Maulana Abdurrahman Leli, please come forward. All those who are organizing the program of the agents at the back, would you please take your seats? Busy at the back. Those brothers who are busy at the back, please take your seat. We want to start prompt at 9:30 as we have said. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Indeed, for the South African Hajj and Umrah Council, we are honored to be in the midst of Hujjaj. And we are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that out of His infinite mercy, He has bestowed us with the ni'mat of serving the Hujjaj. This recording comes live from Johannesburg, the Image Lifestyle Center in Fordsburg, Johannesburg, South Africa. And we welcome the listeners of Radio Islam International and at the same time all those viewers of the video link which is live streaming. We welcome them to Image Lifestyle in Fordsburg, Johannesburg, South Africa. And one of the purposes, just to clarify before we start with the Kalamullah, doing this video live streaming, one of the conditions that we have to have is that we have a Hajj awareness program which We need to inform the Saudi authorities, the Ministry of Hajj and the other departments. So that is why we have this video live streaming also. So by any chance, if they would want to see it also, we have it recorded. And today they may even want to see it there. But I would at the same time say to the operators of the cameras, please refrain as much as you can from taking the ladies, because there are some ladies who don't want to be videoed. So I will appreciate that you respect their view, and we will respect your view at any time and every time. At the same time, one of the rules that I'm sure every Haji has a telephone. We do have a telephone. Please take off your telephones. Let's just look at our telephone that we've got it. Let's put it on silent, so that there's no embarrassment a little later. You can take selfies later when you stand by these posters, then you can take selfies later, no problem. But at the moment, we want absolutely no ringtones. Jazakallah khairul jaza. It will be an honor and privilege for us to start this program off with a recitation from the Holy Quran. I will call upon a man needs no introduction. All of you may have been seeing him on ITV. Maulana Abdurrahman Layli to recite for us from the Holy Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين وإذ بوأنا لإبراهيم مكان البيت ألا تشرك بي شيئا وطهر بيتي للطائفين والقائمين والركع السجود وأذن في الناس بالحج يأتوك رجالا وعلى كل ضامر يأتين من كل فج عميق ليشهدوا منافع لهم ويذكروا اسم الله في أيام معلومات على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام فكلوا منها وأطعموا البائس الفقير ثم ليقضوا تفثهم وليوفوا نذورهم وليتوفوا بالبيت العتيق ذلك ومن يعظم حرمات الله فهو خير له عند ربه وأحلت لكم الأنعام إلا ما يتلى عليكم فاجتنبوا الرجس من الأوثان واجتنبوا قول الزور حنفاء لله غير مشركين به ومن يشرك بالله فكأنما خر من السماء فتخطفه الطير أو تهوي به الريح في مكان سحيق ذلك ومن يعظم شعائر الله فإنها من تقوى القلوب لكم فيها منافع إلى أجل مسمى ثم محلها إلى البيت العتيق ولكل أمة جعلنا منسكا ليذكروا اسم الله على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام فإلهكم إله واحد فله أسلموا وبشر المخبتين الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم والصابرين على ما أصابهم والصابرين على ما أصابهم والمقيم الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والبدن جعلناها لكم من شعائر الله لكم فيها خير فاذكروا اسم الله عليها صواف فإذا وجبت جنوبها فكلوا منها وأطعموا القانع والمؤتر كذلك سخرناها لكم لعلكم تشكرون لن ينال الله لحومها ولا دماؤها ولكن يناله التقوى منكم كذلك سخرها لكم لتكبروا الله على ما هداكم وبشر المحسنين إن الله يدافع عن الذين آمنوا إن الله لا يحب كل خوان كفور صدق الله العظيم
ما شاء الله تبارك الله
ما شاء الله ما شاء الله ما شاء الله جزاك الله مولانا عبد الرحمن for setting the tone for today's Hajj awareness program. I'm sure many of you already by now know that what he has recited is about all about Hajj, about Qurbani, and what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala need at the end of the day. He doesn't need that ibadat of ours. He doesn't even need the blood of that animal that we slaughter. It is the taqwa, is the piety that we need to possess. Brothers and sisters, I welcome you to this Hajj awareness program. I am going to introduce you to the panel that is on the stage. I will start first with myself, your program director. My name is Musa Sidat. On my right is Maulana Abdurrahman Layli. Then we have our brother Shaheen Esop, who is the president of the South African Hajj and Umrah Council. Now you can put a face to what you hear on Radio Islam. So there's Shaheen. He's the man that speaks on Radio Islam many a times. Last night also, he was speaking about coming to this Hajj awareness program. So that's Brother Shaheen Esop. Then we have Hafiz Ismail Kulwadia. Hafiz Ismail is the member of the board also. And I must say that Hafiz Ismail Hajis, you look at me, you look at Shaheen, but you need to see Hafiz Ismail well. He is the man that you deal with when you're in Saudi Arabia. Over the years, he's been the head of the mission. Inshallah, this year we will, inshallah, also, we will have a meeting and then we will tell you who the head of mission, but most probably Hafiz Ismail is the man that you may be dealing with. On his right is Maulana Muhammad Vaid, who I welcome, a warm welcome. He's come all the way from Middelburg, you know, so far away to be here. He is the vice president of South African Hajj and Umrah Council. And then there's a man, young man who's sitting on the right, at the extreme left. He needs no introduction. He's always in the newspapers here locally. It is called, he's Yusuf Tara Sidat. He is the chair of Gauteng. But it seems like we are so quiet. And we are Hujjaj. Hujjaj, when you're going to go to Makkah, when you see the Kaabatullah, what are you going to read? When you leave from here, when you leave Madinatul Munawwara, when you put on your ihram, what are we going to read? Let's read. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. You're going to join me. You have to also, like, you know, when I see some of you at a football and cricket, how you people shout. Now, you can start with me. Men, start with me louder. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك
Now you can see these are hujjat. Now you know. First lesson we learned today is labbaik. I call upon the president of Sahuk, Brother Shaheen, to come and address us. We listened to Shaheen. Just got back from the kingdom. And I wish I was be sitting with you people also there and be a haji also, inshallah, al-aziz. Let's listen to Brother Shaheen.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is indeed an honor to be addressing you here today in preparation for the auspicious journey of Hajj. From the outset, let me state that it is Sahuk's desire for all applicants to perform Hajj. However, as you are aware, we are constrained by the quota that has been assigned to South Africa, which is currently 2,000 pilgrims. Let me elaborate on the quota. The quota is established by the OIC, which is the Organization of Islamic Conferences, back in 1986. I remember I'm stating this year very, very clearly so people can be aware that it's not Sahuk who has been the result of a quota restriction on South Africa. It is a decision that has been made by the government of Saudi Arabia together with the OIC to determine the ratio of people that will come for Hajj from every country around the world based on 1,000 pilgrims per 1 million Muslims. An SMS used to do the rounds, or WhatsApp and social media did a rounds towards the end of last year and the beginning of this year, where, in fact, as late as Monday or Tuesday night, somebody phoned me and said, we heard that there's no longer quotas for this year for South Africa. Now, why is South Africa so special? Why should there be no more quotas for South Africa? Can you imagine, we are 1.6 billion Muslims in the world. If 50% of those are over the age of Bulugh, and of that 50%, 25% are financially able to go for Hajj. That's 400 million people. Now, if there was an open quota and 10% of that 400 million people decided to converge on the plains of Makkah al-Mukarrama or on the Hijaz, do you think it will be accommodated in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia? Logic says no. And as a result of that, we need to understand that there is a quota in place and will always be in place. How they change it in the kingdom depends entirely on their logistics, on their services and facilities. As I said, the quota is established by the OIC and the Saudi Arabian government in order to ensure that they don't receive more persons that they can manage or be accommodated during the 5 days on Mina, Arafah and Muzdalifah. Important for you to understand, people, whilst there are significant renovations happening in Makkah, the Haram, alhamdulillah, is being renovated at a phenomenal pace. In the past, there used to be 48,000 persons that could make tawaf in an hour, and they've reduced it to 25,000 when they put those temporary rings, which, you know, people commonly call donuts in the haram. You have 22 to 25,000 people per hour making tawaf because of the renovations. Inshallah, when they complete, the aim is for 125,000 people to perform tawaf at one time. And we can see the non-strategic pillars that have been taken out, the expansion of the Mataf area, not only on the ground floor, but on the first floor, on the second floor, on the third floor as well. So alhamdulillah, there is a lot of work being done. Given the drop in the price of oil in the last 8-9 months, a lot of things have happened in the kingdom. Things have slowed down. And as a result of that slowdown, we expected that our 500, which was cut 3 years ago, as a result of this renovations, was going to be given back. But unfortunately, that stayed this year as well. So we hope, inshallah, that once the renovations are complete, and we are confident that there will be increases in the quota, which will be forthcoming, inshallah. We've been given these assurances from the Ministry of Health. The quantum thereof and the timing thereof is something that we cannot put on the table right now. So please understand that. Right now, I just want to highlight some of the developments in the Middle East. The economic issues due to the significant decline in the oil price, the removal of fuel subsidies, which results in a lot of increases in the kingdom, specifically fuel, almost 70% increase at the pump, and the knock-on effect of that through various sectors of services and commodities in Saudi Arabia. We've seen hikes in the price of hotels. We've seen hikes in the price of transport. We've also seen hikes in the price of food. Sauk is supported by the government of the Republic of South Africa, albeit that we're a governmental organization. We're an NGO. We don't get any financing from them. Our financing comes from you, the pilgrim, and also from the Ministry of Hajj in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and all its affiliates, the Mutawif, the Adilla, the Nakaba, the Wukala. They all support Sahuk insofar as the administration, organization, and process of Hajj is concerned. Our South African consulate works very closely with Sahuk on all matters relating to Hajj and is also fully supportive. All in all, you are in good hands in your stay in Saudi Arabia. I'm going to break my talk up now into a couple of sectors, and I'm going to start off with South Africa. We're going to talk about the application and accreditation system now. As you all are aware, we've developed a transparent queuing and accreditation system some years ago, which is an ever-evolving system to keep up with technology and security. The purpose of this system was to create a fair and equitable queuing process in order to ensure that first-time pilgrims get preference according to date and time priority. I highlight that. I'm not going to talk about any other factors involved because people come and say, why don't you change the program and give the elderly a little bit of a preference? Why don't you do this and why don't you do that? The minute you start adding parameters into the system, you start getting questioned about the legitimacy of the system. So in order for fairness and transparency and legitimacy, date and time is the best priority in terms of a queue. And I always use this example. Today is the 2nd of April. It's month end. Shopping centers are packed. So everybody does their month end shopping and they go to Pick and Pay. And they stand in the queue and they're 30 deep in the queue. So if I'm 65 years old, does that mean that I must go to the front of the queue now because I'm 65? Or is that person who's been in the front of the queue the person that's going to be the checkout person first? Understand that and put it into our minds to appreciate that whilst we may have a 5-year or 7 or 8-year waiting list, countries like Malaysia have a 67-year waiting list, and their quota is much bigger than ours as well. The ever-increasing evolution from a perspective of more people becoming Dini conscious, wanting to go for Hajj, is resulting in the burgeoning queue. But nobody, and I guarantee you, nobody will be changed in the queue by virtue of any doing that is untoward. So what I'm basically saying here is no one can be promoted up the queue. Our queue is externally audited, and every single change that is done in the system has to have a paper trail for the audit to be reviewed and to be checked and to be verified. So people always say that, you know, oh, you Shaini Sup, well, it's a good thing to know you because you're the head of Sauk. I'm the worst person in Sauk to know because you're not going to get sand in a desert from me. I'm the worst person. You're not going to get any favors, not from anybody sitting on this table, nor from any of my other members around this hall today, or in any of the other provinces around the country. Please understand that. So the registration list can be viewed on our system and is numbered to give applicants an indication where they are in the queue. We've been toying with this for a few years, but we've now numbered the system. And you can actually see that I'm place number 1 or I'm place number 5,000 or I'm place number 3,000 or number 12,000, depending on your date and time of application. Now, this is a dynamic system and a dynamic queue. When I say that, people must understand that if queries are brought to the table and they are legitimate queries and they result in a person being changed and that person moves into the queue on a legitimate structure, remember I told you a few seconds ago about the audit and the information that is presented with it, then that is how the queue will shift over time. But the queue becomes finite once we accredit somebody. So when we release the accreditation list of 2,000, that doesn't change. The only time that accreditation list changes is if you fail to comply by not accepting your accreditation. We then remove you from the system, you lose 30 points, and in order to be regarded as a first-timer again, you must reapply. And then you go to the back of the queue because of date and time priority. We can discuss that a little bit later. I'll give you more clarity on that. The queue as it stands on the system is a registration queue, not an accredited queue. And it is a pre-audit queue, which is still going to be audited, inshallah. Our ambitions in terms of the release of this queue is the end of the last roadshow, which is more or less the 24th of April. We are waiting for our auditor to complete his process. And only once we get sign-off from the auditor do we release the accreditation list into the public domain, inshallah. Hajj preparations for 1436 Sorry, 1437, 2015. As I've indicated, by the 24th of April, we're hoping to get that audit complete. So what is the Hajj's responsibility once you are accredited? You must accept your accreditation online. You pay the SAWQ fees, which is still to be confirmed and determined. Once payment is received by SAWQ and recorded, you may then go back to the system and choose any one of the 21 Hajj operators that we have accredited. Now, you'll notice there's a lot of operators around this room, and these are the accredited operators that we have accredited. Do not, and I appeal to you, do not be duped by people who claim that they are Hajj operators and are not on the list that SAWQ has publicized. Our SAWQ Hajj Registry website has got the list of operators on there that are accredited. So you can look at that list. Their email addresses are on there. Their telephone numbers are on there. And you'll be able to verify from that list who is an accredited operator and who is not. So once the payments are reflected, then you as a Haji, once you have selected operator A, B, or C, will then move into the portal of that operator. And you can now go and do the necessary contracting and complete what is necessary with that Hajj operator. The rand-dollar exchange rate as well has increased costs in Saudi Arabia for the Haji as well as for SAWQ. We are not excluded from those changes in exchange rate fluctuation. We suffer just as much as you do. And that is why we have not yet determined the fees that Hujjaj will pay, which will inshallah be done next week at our board meeting. But I just want to give you a statistic. Last year we collected 1,000 rands per pilgrim, or 1,100 rands per pilgrim as a fee. And the cost per haji was in excess of 1,500 rands, which means SAWQ subsidized each pilgrim by almost 50% of the value that they paid in hajj fees. We pay, let me explain to you what we use the money for that you actually pay us. The registration fees that you've paid is a once-off payment, and that is used for the service of the system and the internet services that we provide to an external provider. The fees that you pay once accredited goes back into the servicing of you pilgrims. Again, none of the members of SAWQ sitting in front of you here on the executive earn a salary. I have three paid staff across the country, one in Cape Town, one in Johannesburg, and one in Durban. Nobody on the executive takes a salary from SAWQ. We do this, alhamdulillah, for the pleasure of Allah, and we do this to serve the Hujjaj. This is our form of giving back to our community, inshallah. The money that is paid goes into the securing of tickets, accommodation, and facilities in the kingdom for our mission and medical mission. We have 26 personnel that go to the kingdom with you. 10 of them are doctors and nurses, professional doctors and nurses. And the balance are mission workers that will be based in Jeddah, Medina, and in Makkah, as well as in Azizia when everybody converges, and then moving on to the 5 days of the Mashair with you. So you will have SAWQ affiliates and SAWQ service providers, as well as your operators, with you all the way. From the time you leave this country to the time you enter the country, through to your whole process of Hajj and in your departure from Hajj back to South Africa. Our clinics are established in Medina, in Makkah, as well as in Azizia. And you can visit the clinics at your, you know, at your best junctures, whenever you require. There are times that the clinics are available, and later when Dr. Akil comes on or Hafiz Ismail comes on, they will talk to you about the times that the clinics are operational in those various cities. We don't charge you for a clinic visit. You have paid your SAWQ fees. You come there when you are ill. You come there when there is a need. In the last 3 years, we've had 6,000 Hujjaj, 2,000 per annum. But every year, we have serviced in excess of 7,000 pilgrims at the clinics in Makkah, Medina, and Azizia, which tells you that people go multiple times. And when you understand the cost of a doctor's visit in South Africa, and think of how much you are paying for your service fees, just from a medical perspective, you've eroded that if you've gone twice to one of our clinics. So understand when I talk about the subsidy in terms of what SAWQ is doing and repatriating back into the community, inshallah. We now come on to contracting. You contract with the operator of choice. Now, before we go on to more details of the operators contracting and you contracting with them, I want to ask all of you, who in the audience can lift their hand and tell me what tawakkul is? The word tawakkul. Can somebody please tell me what that word is? Trust. Now let me give you a better example. Tawakkal is signing a blank contract and letting Allah determine the terms and conditions of that contract. Now, who do you place your trust in when you have tawakkul? In Allah. You don't sign a blank contract with the Hajj operator. Please. I beg you. It may be facetious. It may sound like I'm rapping on the operators. We've had experiences of these issues in the past. Every one of them is trustworthy, because if they're not trustworthy, we are not going to accredit them. We have accredited them on the basis of their services and their ability to lead you in logistics and to lead you in terms of your Hajj. But you must remember, any contract is a trust between two people. And you can't come back to Sahuk when there is a dispute and say, he said, she said, he said, she said. We go according to what is written on a piece of paper, because that is law in South Africa. If the contract states that I'm going to receive a 4-star building in Medina, I'm going to receive a 4-star building in Makkah, I'm going to receive a hotel in Azizia or a building in Azizia, shared 4 in a room, 5 in a room, then I can't turn around and say, but he said that I'm going to get 2 in a room. If you did not negotiate that, or if you did not write that down, then you have a problem. So please, I implore you, and I repeat this annually, every single year, I implore you, look at the package, agree on the package, fill in the contract according to the package, and sign that document. Make sure you have a copy, make sure your Hajj operator has a copy, because that copy is going to be uploaded onto our website, inshallah, in order for us to have a copy thereof for any dispute resolution. Once you've done your contracting, and I implore you, the volatility in our exchange rate, if you have got the money for your Hajj, pay the Hajj operator in full. Pay that person. Why must you take the risk for currency fluctuation? All of their packages state the prices are subject to currency fluctuation, which is 100% correct. They have a right to do that, because if you pay them 25% now and the rand-dollar exchange rate moves by 50%, as we've seen in the last 12 months, who is subjected to that difference in payment? You or them? It's definitely going to be you if you haven't paid the full amount. If you can pay the full amounts, pay it and leave the risk up to the operator. Because if there's any change in the currency after that, it's their risk, it's not yours. So that is an advice that I'd like to give you from that perspective. Ensure that the contract has the following: accommodation info for Makkah, Medina, Azizia, and ensure that you have the flight information for a round trip to your city of residence. Please note, it is better to do flight arrangements with your agents, because booking tickets on your own can lead to issues that you may have when departing Saudi Arabia. Now, whilst I say that, there are Hajj operators who will offer you your full package. And I have to say this in front of the operators. I'm not having a dig at them, but I'm just going to say it. There are some operators who do block bookings, and they get the prices slightly cheaper. They're all entitled to make a profit, but let that profit be reasonable. Let's not skin the pilgrims, especially from a perspective of where we stand with the rand-dollar exchange rate movements, with the economic situation here, as well as the economic situation in the kingdom. Let us be fair to each other, and let us look at the longevity of our process rather than look at short-term gains, inshallah. Please read all the information on the operator contracts very carefully, especially cancellation clauses, because this is very vital to you. You may find yourself wanting, especially from a perspective of any cancellation penalties that may be imposed. Our Hajj mission head from last year will lead you into discussion regarding the processes in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and SAUK's role. Our medical representative a little later will lead you through medical requirements, the do's, the don'ts, regarding keeping yourself in good health. Now, all of us know that within the Muslim community, we've had Operation Hydrate in South Africa. And that has been plastered all over the TV screens and all over social media and various other places. The one thing that you need to understand, we are going to continue with Operation Hydrate in Saudi Arabia. Not because we want water, but because we want you to be hydrated. We're going into the summer months for the next 10 years in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And Hajj will be in excess of 48 to 51 to 52 degrees. You need to ensure that you constantly hydrate yourself. I'm not saying go and buy Pepsis and Cokes all over the show. Zamzam water is freely available. Make sure you drink tons and tons of Zamzam water, please. And make sure those of you who want to walk, they'll discourage you from walking. I too will discourage you from walking in that heat, because it will dehydrate you to no end. Ensure that you are kept in good spirits, because ultimately, people, Hajj is Arafah. If you are not present on the plains of Arafah, then you haven't made Hajj. Then you can't come back to Sawak and say, you know what, I didn't look after myself. I need you to re-accredit me next year. It's not going to happen. Please understand that. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for you to take in terms of your process. In terms of shoes as well. You know, we spend, Hafiz Ismail will give you more detail, but we spend so much money on Hajj packages, and we spend so much money on our bags, and then we go and buy a 5 riyal slipper, or we go and buy the cheapest sandal. Buy a sandal now and start wearing that sandal now. Wear it now so that it becomes a piece of your anatomy when you are walking in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. People often ask me, what advice can you give a pilgrim? I say there's two things you give a pilgrim. I'm not an alim, so the alims will give you all the dini advice. But you must learn to sit on the floor for long periods of time. And in sitting on the floor for long periods of time, you need to make sure that you can keep your wudu for long periods of time. And the second is you must learn to walk. Because there's no cars, there's no buses, there's no taxis in Saudi Arabia for you to, you know, pick up your finger and jump. They're going to cost you a lot of money. You must learn to walk. And when you learn to walk, you're making yourself fit. You're preparing yourself for the 5 days of Hajj and also preparing yourselves for Arafah as well, inshallah. Some pertinent advices that I can offer for those who have not traveled out of our country before. If you're on chronic medication, carry a letter from your doctor or from your clinic for the meds in your possession. Also carry any insulin for those people who want diabetes that may be required, because this is not freely available in Saudi Arabia. Adhere to the security rules in the airports. No bottles in hand luggage more than 100 milliliters. If people want to give you a cold drink, and we normally find this, somebody at the airport says, take this with you, you know, it's a little bit of barakat, you know, drink it on the plane. Take the 10 rand from them or the 15 rand from them and buy the cold drink on the other side of immigration. The reason being is that you take a 500 mil or a 330 mil cold drink, it only goes as far as the security counter because they throw that in the bin and that gets dumped. So you don't want to waste people's money and people's niyyah as well. I cannot emphasize on this point enough. Do not carry narcotics. Saudi Arabia has a death penalty for drug trafficking. Now, people may think I'm mad. We're talking to Hujaj, okay? Believe me, if you read the Saudi newspapers on a weekly basis, people coming for Umrah, mules disguised as Mu'tamirin, coming in to perform Umrah, carrying drugs, are being caught and being, you know, prosecuted as a result. We have not had a South African in that position as yet, and we don't want to have a South African in that position. SAUK, the consulate, or our government will not assist you in this regard. If you carry forbidden narcotics, you are on your own. Please understand that. You carry enough cash with you that you may need. However, ATMs are freely available in Makkah, Medina, and Azizia, and you can use your Standard Bank, your Net Bank, your Absa, your FNB, or whatever card you have. As long as it's got the chip and it's got the necessary bank structures, you're able to use it to withdraw money in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And you won't draw rands, you'll draw riyals. They obviously do the necessary from a perspective of the exchange rate online. Upon arrival in Jeddah or Medina airports, you'll be welcomed by our members of the Sawak Hajj Mission who are there to facilitate your smooth transition and movement from the airport to the Hajj terminal to your destination. The Muassasa will take your passport at this time, and you'll only see your passport again when you return back to South Africa at the airport, either at Hajj terminal or at the North or South terminal, depending on your airline that you're going to be flying with. Our Hajj mission will be based in Jeddah, Medina, Makkah, and Azizia. And as I said earlier, clinics will be set up in Medina, Makkah, and Azizia, as well as the location which will be made available. In fact, our location will be made available to your selected Hajj operator upon the arrival in Saudi Arabia. So wherever we're going to be based, your operator will have the necessary information, and each of you will then be informed where it is. Very importantly for me to extrapolate on the following, that strict adherence to the requirements as set out by the Ministry of Hajj, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and other affiliates in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia must be observed. For example, you are here to perform Hajj. Concentrate on that, and do not engage in any politicized gatherings. You could find yourself being expelled from the country for failure to adhere to their rules. We must remember, whilst we are the guests of Allah, ultimately, we are also the guests of the Saudi Arabian government. And we need to conduct ourselves in a manner that is appropriate. If you have a guest in your home, you expect that guest to act and to conduct him or herself appropriately. That person cannot be out of line, otherwise you will ask them to leave your home and probably never invite them back again. There's no difference to this, it's on a bigger scale. Please adhere to the pelting rules as well and other instructions that the head of mission or the team may advise you, because this will ensure your safety and the safety of others as well. We ask that you be ensured, and we ask that you ensure that you are acquainted with the manasik, which are the procedures of Hajj, and that you have learned the necessary arkans of the Hajj in order to have a pleasant journey, inshallah. Remember, your Hajj operator sees to your logistics. Hajj is between you and Allah. It is a once-in-a-lifetime experience, so you must make the most of it with no regrets. It is our sincere dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants every Hajji that is accredited a Hajj maqbool wa mabroor, inshallah. Jazakallah khairan for your attentive listening, and I will be available a little bit later for any individual questions or any questions that may be posed. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah, brother Shaheen. I just want to pick up 2 points that Shaheen has said. One was a contract that Shaheen has talked about. And then he said, don't buy a 5 rial sandal. Aunties, I want to say, when you want to do the walk-in Hajj, don't buy a high heel shoe. It's going to be difficult for you to walk all the way from Makkah to Mina, Arafat, Muzdalifah, back to Makkah, and then when that high heel shoe of yours on the way it breaks and you have blisters, then you've got enough problems. And if you think we are joking, you can ask our medical mission. They will tell you the amount of blisters our aunties come with. So please, regarding the shoes, very important. And where Brother Shaheen spoke about the contract, let me say to you, every year we say this to the Hujjaj, sign a contract. Why sign a contract? In the contract it says what type of a room you're going to get. A friend of mine's, he went for Hajj some years ago, and the agent told him, and no disrespect to any of our agents here, and they told him, when you go to Medina, when you open the curtain, you will see the haram in front of you. So this young man, when he got to Madinatul Munawwara, when he got to his room, the first thing he did is he pulled a curtain, and you know what he's seen? A wall. He's seen the wall, so he went immediately. Now he's furious. They told me I'm going to get a room with a view of the haram. And he went to the reception. And at the reception, he met a man and he talked to this man. And this man never understood him. He never understood the man. But the man said, inshallah bukra, don't worry, tomorrow. Broken English. So this man tolerated it. The next day, he after dhuhr, again, he went to the reception and he sees another person there now. And he tells him, the man yesterday said he's going to change my room because I was supposed to get a room with the view of the haram. And they talking, and this guy lost it. He lost his temper and he banged the table, the desk, and the glass shattered. When the glass shattered, the receptionist didn't say anything. He didn't argue with the man. He just picked up the phone. He spoke to somebody. He put the phone down. After 5 minutes, this brother was in the police car. They handcuffed him and they took him. And where they took him to, they didn't take him to the police station. They didn't take him to any cell. They took him to the mad hospital. Right? He went to the mad hospital. And now in the mad hospital, what happens? There are doctors that see you. Once a week, they come visit you. So now if you see the doctor passing by and you shout, doctor, doctor, he's not going to look at you because they know they are mad people, yeah. So on a Thursday, after spending about 8 or 9 days, on a Thursday, a Pakistani doctor came to him and he told the doctor, this is what has happened. This is what happened to me. I was promised this room. I didn't get it. I lost it also. I banged the table, the desk. I shattered the glass. He intervened. Within a day, they gave him 200 riyal and they packed him off to Makkah immediately because it was just time for Hajj. So, don't get mad. Don't get mad at us. We nag you for all these things that we talk about. Because at the end of the day, what you are paying for, you will get. But if you write it down. And that is the way of our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa taslim. I am going to call upon a young little boy. Surely on Radio Islam you have been hearing last year, we had a Qari Ihsan Mohsin Muhammad Qasmi who visited the shores of South Africa. And he had been reciting many naats and nazams. And there was one very favorite nazm. Even an old man and old lady who didn't know how to sing were singing it. So I am going to call upon Hafiz Saad Sidat to come and render that naat of Qari Ihsan Mohsin, so that in our hearts and the love that we have of our Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam increases and increases and increases. Hafiz Saad. We'll stand.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. ओ जिसके लिए महफिल कोनें सजी है फिरदौस से भरे जिसके वसीने से बनी है वो हाशमी मक्की वो हाशमी मक्की मदनीउल अरबी है ओ मेरा नबी है ओ मेरा नबी है ओ मेरा नबी है अहमद है मोहम्मद है वही खत्म रसूल है मखदूम मुरब्बी है वही वाली कुल है उस पर ही नजर उस पर ही नजर सारे जमाने की लगी है वो मेरा नबी है والشمس ضحى چهرہ ہے انور کی جھلک ہے والليل سجا سیس ہوئے حضرت کی لچک ہے عالم کو ضیا جس کے وسیلے سے ملی ہے وہ میرا نبی मेरा नबी है वो मेरा नबी है वो मेरा नबी है अल्लाह कफर मालम نشرح لك صدرك منسوب ہے جس سے ورفعنا لك ذكرك جس ذات کا قرآن جس ذات کا قرآن میں بے ذکر جلی ہے او میرا نبی ہے او میرا نبی ہے او میرا نبی ہے جس در کا زمانے میں بھی مظلوم بے عورت پھر کس کی بدولت ملی سے عزت اور رفعت وہ محسن غم خار وہ محسن غم خار ہمارا ہی نبی ہے وہ میرا نبی میرا نبی میرا نبی ہے وہ میرا نبی میرا نبی میرا نبی ہے وہ میرا نبی ہے وہ جس کے لیے محفل کونین سجی ہے پھر دو سے بری جس کے وسیلے سے بنی ہے وہ ہاشمی مکی وہ ہاشمی مکی مدنی العربی ہے وہ میرا نبی میرا نبی میرا نبی ہے وہ ان کا نبی ان کا نبی سب کا نبی ہے وہ میرا نبی ہے وہ میرا نبی ہے جزاک اللہ
ماشاء اللہ there is no doubt وہ میرا نبی ہے for who the entire verses the worlds whatever is in the worlds because of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam it was made and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam just that one little line that we heard it was when ladies our sisters had no place in community in society they had no say they were buried alive when they were little girls and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and liberated the females and the mothers and that who is he wo mera nabi hai and we are honored we should be thankful to Allah this great ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has bestowed us being the ummatis of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa taslim friends Hujjajatul Kiram, listeners of Radio Islam, those who are viewing us on the live streaming, let me say to you, I'm going to call upon the head of mission, Hafiz Ismail Kulwadia, who is going to discuss about the mission. I want you to listen very attentively about what the inners of Hajj is not just going there but what happens when you land when you go to Madinatul Munawwara when you go from Madinatul Munawwara to Makkah Muazzama and Hafiz Ismail is going to touch on the medical aspects also after Hafiz Ismail finishes then we will have a session for question and answers and then you can pose your questions to the panel regarding whatever has been discussed and whatever your concerns are then we will address that thereafter we will have a representative of Radio Islam who will come and give us some advices thereafter our program is if there's time we will still carry on but inshallah we will say jazakallah to Radio Islam at 5 to 12 we will say to the listeners of Islam because we will round up with them at 5 to 12 because then they go for a para a day but we will carry on inshallah al-aziz I call upon Hafiz Ismail Kulwadia who is the head of mission Hafiz Saab please
السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ نحمدہ ونصلی علی رسولہ الکریم اما بعد فاعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم والعصر ان الانسان لفی خسر الا الذین آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسول النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. Firstly, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for using us to serve His guest, and that is the Hujjaj Kiram. I'm not going to go into too much of introduction. Time is of constraints. I have a fairly lengthy situation to explain, so I think I'm going to go right into it. The ingredients for a successful Hajj. What I'm going to be relating to you is basically from experiences that we have had. So I'm not a boffin as far as Hajj is concerned, but I can only relate to the experiences over the last 8 or 9 years, and inshallah, I'm confident that if you take this experience into consideration, you will benefit, and inshallah, your trip will be a successful one. What I have found, discipline, cooperation, perseverance, patience, and sacrifice is the basic ingredient that all of us have to have in order to make this journey a successful one. If we have all those factors, then believe you me, it's going to be easy for you, it's going to be easy for us as the mission, and it's going to be easy for the authorities in the kingdom. What I need to tell you that Sahuk is not authority. A lot of people have this perception that if they see a mission worker with a burp or they see him at the airport, they think that this is authority. And when we see authority, we tend to act in a very negative way. What I want to emphasize that Sahuk is a support structure. We are there to assist you. The reason I say that, a lot of times the individuals are antagonistic towards the people who are serving you. And there's a common saying in English, if you give respect, the person on the other side is only but obligated to give you respect. If you give him disrespect, the correct way was to still give him respect. But unfortunately, we are human beings and people react differently. I can give you the undertaking that the mission members that have been on the mission in the past would go the extra mile if you treat them accordingly. And that is a Sharia injunction. I don't think I have to elaborate too much on that. Another very important thing is attitude. Many a people have different attitudes. If you give aggression, like I just mentioned earlier, you're going to get back aggression. If you are humble, the guy will come back to you in a humble way. So I need to make this clear that as a mission and as Sahuk, we will be there wherever you need us to support you, to take care of you, and to facilitate. If you go with that concept, believe you me, you will be a happy Haji. The first port or the first point you are going to meet up with the Sahuk guys is going to be at the airports. Come Johannesburg, Cape Town, or Durban. Now, they are there to guide you, just to make your flow easy. They will sometimes ask you for your passport, to want to check your visa. It's not because they want to decide, now, no, you can't go for Hajj, or you go to, if they tell you, go stand in that queue. It is because we have a coordination agreement with EXA to make it easy for the Hajjis to flow through. So again, they are going to be there to assist you. The other issue we have is we have one Haji going or a couple going, and then we have 250 people that come to bid farewell to this one particular Haji. With the result is the airport is totally jam-packed and we become a nuisance to the fellow users of that facility. I think we need to take cognizance of this fact, and we need to understand that let's do the farewell at home. I'm not saying people shouldn't come to the airport. If you now look at OR Tambo at the moment, there's quite a bit of the area that they have cordoned off where they don't want to allow non-passengers beyond that point. Now, if you got 50 hajis going and 200 people times 50, there's no place for anybody else. And I think we need to portray what Islam is all about in the manner that we conduct ourselves. So that is where we're going to meet you initially, at the airports. Again, if we tell you that please congregate at that particular corner or that side, it is not that we want to show authority. It is because we need to facilitate and to make sure that we don't become a hindrance to other people that are using that facility. Depending on where you're going to fly, whether you're going to go to Jeddah or whether you're going to go to Medina, our recommendation as Sahuk and as a mission, that every Haji should fly to Medina. And I will explain to you as we go on why we make that recommendation. We understand there are times, there are going to be situations where you might not get bookings for Jeddah and you are forced to go to Jeddah. But from our experiences, we found that Jeddah Airport is a problematic airport. When I say problematic, I'm not talking from the authorities' point of view, but from a facilitating point of view, especially if you land at Hajj terminal. The infrastructure is there, but is not suitable for us. The heat is excessive. The waits are long. You already have an 8-hour flight, depending whether you're coming directly with Saudi or whether you're coming via Emirates or Qatar or whatever it may be. So a lot of frustration creeps in when you get to Jeddah. So we recommend, and we have found over the years, that Medina is a lot more comfortable, and now specifically that they have opened up another airport specifically for Hajis. The facilities are absolutely phenomenal. The procedures are a lot more easy, and you find that you are much more comfortable in Medina. Even the people that you interact with there are a lot more concerning and a lot more friendlier. Not that I want to take anything away from the guys in Jeddah. Now, the problem in Jeddah is that the Hajj terminal, you come in there, you could be, there were times, although there is a objective at this point in time, that they want to release you within 55 minutes from airport landing. That means once you come into immigration. But they haven't been successful. We hope in the future that this will be achieved. But when you come in there, you land, and the airport is a massive airport. You are bus to the Hajj terminal. From there, the baggage gets transferred. It is quite a distance. So your wait at immigration, depending on how efficient they are, and if there is no breakdowns or no electrical failures or computer issues, it will take you between 4 and 6 hours to clear immigration and customs. There was times last year that we managed to do it in 2 hours, but that is all based on circumstances. After that, we need to arrange for transportation. Depending whether you're going to take a flight to Medina, majority of the people go by bus. We have to then coordinate with the United Agents Office, who are responsible for the transportation. Your passports are taken away, you are taken and you are assembled at a particular point. We got to wait for a bus and then load you on the bus. The rule is that there must be 40 passengers minimum in order to get the bus immediately. Anything under that becomes problematic in the later stage. In the earlier stage, 35, 34, 30, they will facilitate. Now, as South Africans, we tend to be more comfortable with our own people. So if those are going to be fives and tens, then you must be prepared that you are going to be sharing a bus with another country, with another nationality, because it doesn't pay them. So we recommend that people come, if they're coming, especially to Jeddah, They should come in groups of 40 or more because the bus can facilitate that amount of people. If you have that, it makes our task a lot more easier. Your wait is less at the airport because we have the group. We can put you on the bus and you go. Your baggage just comes out. You recognize your baggage. You identify it. It's eventually put onto the bus and then you leave. Now, depending on the buses, we've had a lot of issues with buses in Saudi Arabia per se. That particular sector from the Jeddah Hajj terminal to Medina is non-negotiable. They will not allow any other bus but the bus that the government provides. As much as we tell them that we need air cons and we need good buses and you know all those type of things, those negotiations are done. But there is a tendency from time to time that you get a bus that the aircon doesn't work, or you get a bus that is maybe not comfortable. Now you will understand why I'm recommending that you fly to Medina. But the reality is, if you're going to fly in Jeddah, I need to build you up mentally so that you know what to expect. So hopefully when you get there, you won't be frustrated. You get onto that bus, and if that bus in good running condition will take you between 8 and 12 hours to get to Medina. Sometimes 6 hours. It's all depending on traffic. I'm trying to go the maximum hours so that if you get there in 4 hours, you reckon, alhamdulillah. If you get there in 10 hours, you say, no, I was warned, so I mustn't make a noise about it. So I'm giving you the average times, between 8 and 12 hours. Once you get to Medina, there will be a team, there's a point known as Hijra. There's a checkpoint there. Now, when we went, we just came back on Saturday last week, I see the checkpoint has been taken away. Now, whether it's a temporary thing or whether it's going to be re-installed at a later time, I can't tell you. But it is that last checkpoint that we used to have getting into Medina where the Hijra office is. And again, there will be Sahuk representatives there to welcome you. Again, if they come onto the bus, they're purely coming to find out your condition. Sometimes they will ask you for contracts. Although these arrangements are made prior to your bus coming there with the relevant operators, but there might be times that they might need some information. So again, we understand your tiredness, we understand your fatigue, but if a guy comes to you, he's coming there because he's instructed to do so. Again, if all the documentation is in place, within half an hour, you will leave Hijra. They will do the confirmation of your hotels. That is the point where they do confirmations. They confirm with the hotelier that there's X amount of passengers coming from certain operator. They're going to this particular hotel. Once those confirmations are done, the bus then leaves and goes to the hotel. Now, those people that are flying to Medina, very similar situation. There will be a group of Sahuk volunteers there that will welcome you, assist you, try and push you through all the procedures. And as much as you cooperate with them, the quicker you will get access. Medina, to get from Medina to your hotel, doesn't take you more than half an hour. The releasing point from immigration out to customs, we've done it in 2 hours in Medina. So you find Medina is a lot more comfortable. So again, it's an advice that I'm giving you, but I also understand there might be circumstances where you might not be able to do that. Anybody under the group of 40, I appeal to the operators and I appeal to the Hajis, please fly to Medina. That should be non-negotiable because it becomes a major problem to facilitate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Hajis from Jeddah into Medina. There are times where we have taken South Africans and put them with Nigerians or with Senegalese or with Kenyans, and then the Hajis get all upset. Is this what I paid for? Is this what is expected of you people? Now, the frustration is somewhere else, and the aggravation is taken out on us. So we are pre-warning the Hajis that if you are coming in small groups, I strongly recommend that you land in Medina. It's going to cost you a few rands extra. But inshallahul aziz, you will appreciate what I'm telling you when you experience that. As our president has mentioned, we have a clinic facility that will be based in Medina. It's going to be at the Tayyiba Suites on the third floor. Inshallah, the relevant notices will be sent out. I will elaborate more on the clinics as we go on, but I just need to tell you about other things relating to traveling. Baggage. Very important, we have found that we have a lot of issues with lost baggages, specifically with people landing in Jeddah. Firstly, I need to tell you that Saudi Arabian Airlines allows you 2x23 kilo bags, not 24 kilos, 23 kilos. In Johannesburg, they are absolutely strict. And to me, it's an embarrassment if they have to ask me to open up the bag and remove stuff to make my bag come to 23. So let us be prepared. Take two bags, make sure it's 23 kilos. In Saudi, sometimes you get away with it. But in Joburg, I can tell you that lady is on your case. So that is Saudi Airlines. Any other airlines, the allowance is 30 kgs. Maximum 32 kgs. If you have anything more than 32 kgs, they will not allow that bag on the flight because they're not allowed to load more than 32 kilos for loading purposes. Number two, you need to mark your bags appropriately, especially when you're on Saudi Airlines. Because when the flight goes, it's not necessarily only Hajis. There are non-Hajis, there are workers on that flight. And when the plane lands, they make an announcement that all those people who are Hajis must go onto a particular bus, and all those who are going to be working or got different visas, Hajj visas and visitors visas, they have to go on a different bus. That means the people who are visitors, they go to a different terminal, and the Hajis go to a different terminal. So you got to make sure that your bags are adequately, properly marked, and we've got to also make sure that when you check in, they put the relevant Hajj tag on that bag. Otherwise, in Saudi, in Jeddah, it's an absolute nightmare to get the bags from one terminal to the other terminal. In distance from visibly looking at it, it's probably 10 minutes. But by road, it takes you half an hour to go from one terminal to the other terminal. And the Hajis are always in a panic if the bags are not there. So just make sure that you adequately mark it. Sahuk will provide stickers to put on the bags. And just make sure when you check in that the Hajj tag is on that bag. So when they offload the bags in Jeddah, those bags come to Hajj terminal rather going to the other terminal. While I'm on the baggage, before I forget, there's a tendency that bags get lost or they don't get loaded on the flight. Now, my recommendation is husband and wife, pack the bags half and half. Half of your clothes, half of the wife's clothes, in that way. So if one of the bags get missing, you still have something to continue. If you put everything of yours in one bag and you come there and your bag is not there, then you are in an absolute dilemma. The same thing applies to medication, because you find a lot of times people come, you know what, my medication was in the other bag and the bag is not here. Split the medication up in 3-4 different bags, so that in the event there's a delay with the baggage, you have to still some medication to continue. So please take heed of that, and inshallah in that way we will be able to facilitate. If your bags get lost, yes, you report it to the relevant authorities. A lot of times the Hajis come there, and they expect now Sahuk to fetch the bag. Sahuk is not there to carry your bags and push you around and all those type of things. We are there to facilitate your needs. Yes, you need to inform us. We understand when you come to Jeddah, you can't sit there the whole day and wait for your bags. Do the relevant reporting. Inform the person who's there that, you know, my bag has been delayed or hasn't come or whatever the case may be. He will take down your particulars, take down who your agent is. Your agent and ourselves, we work quite well together, and then we will make sure that we will get the bag to you wherever you are. But South Africans generally, 99.9% all go to Medina first. So again, these are the challenges that we have in Jeddah, so I'm just mentioning this to you while we're talking about the baggage. Okay, the transportation I have covered. And then, like I said, from Medina, after you spend your 9 days or 10 days, depending on what your contract states, and I think I need to mention about this because, you know, last year we had this saga where the plane got delayed for 3 days, and the people take out their frustration on Sahuk. We don't own Saudi Airlines. Believe you me, we don't own it. We don't have a share there. That's beyond our control. I mean, that is Saudi Airlines' problem. Now, people want credit because you know why, that the flight got delayed for 3 days and Sahuk must intervene. What can we do about it? Yes, we can make your journey a pleasurable one. We can assist you at the airports and see what best we can do. But taking out your frustration on us really is not going to solve the problem. So again, you got to understand the differences and the responsibilities that we have as a mission and your operator has. But again, we will be there to listen to you and assist you in whichever way we can. After you spend your 10 days, you normally move. There are majority of the South Africans move by bus from Medina into Makkatul Mukarrama. Now, I'm going to say something here, and I think some of them are going to take objections, especially my colleagues from the travel fraternity. But I think it's important that I mention this to you so that if they have to tell you something different, you will understand where it comes from. As I mentioned to you early on, we have problems with buses. And this has been a problem for as long as I know myself doing the mission. And I don't know whether it's going to be resolved. We're going to try different mechanisms this year. So hopefully it will get resolved. These buses are provided by the ministry. There's a department known as Naqaba, which is in charge of transport. But I need to reiterate, that arrangement is done between the operator and the Haji. It's got nothing to do with Sahuk. Sahuk don't facilitate those buses. What Sahuk does, it relays the information to the authorities that, you know, there's X amount of passengers that are going to go from Medina to Makkah, so that we have to inform the office in Makkah, the buses are arriving, who the relevant operators are, and those type. But we don't hire the buses, nor do we make arrangements for the buses. Now, I'm going to mention something to you. I don't know whether the operators are going to implement this year, but last year, I took it upon myself to discuss this problem with the Malaysian mission. And the Malaysian mission echoed my sentiments and said we had the same problem. And I must tell you, one of the best and the well-organized mission is the Malaysian mission known as Tabung Haji. And he gave us a solution to this problem in their way. And that was they contracted with private bus operators. When you go there, if Allah takes you, inshallah, you will see that the Malaysians mostly travel in Mercedes buses. And it has cost them extra. Your transportation is generally covered in your tanazzul. But there was an extra cost that was levied to the Malaysian mission. But because of the problems, they opted to pay that extra to facilitate the Hajj's movement from Medina to Makkah in better and comfortable buses. But we have a few challenges as South Africans. We go with 23 kilos, and we come back with 123 kilos. Now, that is a problem. With the Malaysians, they're very disciplined, very organized. Same color bags, same size bags. They make arrangements with trucks to take their buses, you know, their baggages before, and those type of things. So they overcame their challenge. Now, I don't know how we as South Africans are going to come, because 9 out of 10 times we have a problem loading the buses in Medina, because instead of 2 pieces, the Haji got 4 pieces, and some got 5 pieces. Then he's got an extra bag, and he's got a box, and it's a nightmare, believe you me. So I don't know how the operators are going to try and facilitate this, but we have brought this to their notice, and I think they also understand it, but they're going to try something different. So I just need to clear that Sahuk is not responsible for the buses. And I mentioned to you earlier on that the one from the Hajj terminal to Medina is non-negotiable. For security reasons, they will allow no private busing. But from Medina outwards, if you need any other buses, you have the option of contracting with private operators, obviously at the additional cost. Once you leave there, again, Sahuk will be there to assist you, get you on the buses in cooperation with the operators. We'll do all the necessary. From there, you go to the recommendation from the ministry. Normally, the buses go to Bir Ali. Bir Ali is a place where you tie your ihram and you have your shower and all those type of things, and you prepare to go to Makkah. But the recommendation from the ministry is that we should try and facilitate all those things in our hotels before we get onto the bus. Because Bir Ali becomes crowded, it becomes an issue as far as the cleanliness of the bathrooms is concerned, the toilet facilities and things like this. So we also carrying that recommendation to South African Hujjaj that prepare yourself, tie your ihram, read your two rakat salatul ihram in the haram. You know what I'm saying is, and prepare yourself there. They will go to Biladi for procedural reasons, but don't get off the bus because it causes a lot of unnecessary delay. Yes, we do understand circumstantially. Sometimes people need to go to toilet or whatever. I don't have a problem with that. But the recommendation is get yourself ready in Medina, in the hotels, jump onto the bus, and inshallahul aziz, you'll be on your way with minimum delays. Like I said, depending on the type of bus, that journey can take you between 8 and 12 hours. That's the most difficult journey that I have sort of experience with the Hajjis, you know, because I suppose with the excitement and what have you and whatnot. But again, I think I've made the point clear that we would try our best to facilitate, but let's see how we can facilitate the busing. The Medina, like I've mentioned to you, there will be a clinic there, and I'll go on later to elaborate what we provide in the clinic. And then when you come to Makkah, again, you will be reporting to the Muassasa office. In Medina, the Muassasa is known as the Adilla. In Makkah, Muassasa is known as Muassasa. You come to the office there, there will be Sahuk guys present there to welcome you, to explain you what the situations are, what the procedures are. The Muassasa will get onto the bus, and they will put a band around your arm. It's a sort of a plastic thing that they put around your arm with the name of the office, South African, what have you, and whatnot. Now, that is a very important identification band. The idea of that band is that in the event you get lost, disorientated, sick, or you just lose yourself, that band will make it easy for the authorities to know who they must contact in the event you are found incapacitated at any place in Makkatul Mukarramah. That means the police force or whoever. You can ask anybody. And the minute you show the band, they know exactly who to refer you to. Now, we've had incidents in the past. People put this band on, then they say when they go in a shower, they take it out. Then they forget to put it on. The Haji gets lost, we find him after 4 days. Generally, after 24 hours, you start looking for him in the mortuary. Now, 4 days, if you don't find him, it starts creating panic among the fellow Hajis, among the operator, amongst the mission, amongst the authorities. So it is highly important that you make sure that that band is maintained. If it breaks, or if it, whatever happens, report it to your operator, report it to the mission, we'll get you a replacement band. But I think you need to have this principle that every given time, whether you're there for 6 weeks, 5 weeks, 4 weeks, 3 weeks, there mustn't be a second that you don't have that band. Even if you go to the toilet, leave it on. You go in a shower, it's a waterproof band. Nothing will happen to it. Go with it in the shower. Because you just didn't know what's going to happen and when it's going to happen. Okay, so I think I've explained that part of it. So that has to be taken care of. Once you come there, again, the Sahu guys will be there. They will be on your bus, get you to your hotel, get you settled down and make you as comfortable as you have. In Medina, generally, we don't have a problem. The hotels are quite nice. Our operators facilitate good hotels there. In Makkah also, these days, the hotels are good. Inshallahul Aziz, if you contract properly and you check your contracts out properly, I don't think you'll have a problem from the accommodation point of view. But in the event you do have a problem, I think the first port or the first person to contact is your operator. For example, you go there and you find that Qari Sahib mentioned haram view was promised or whatever the circumstances. And if you are not happy, I think go and speak to your operator. I'm pretty confident 9 out of 10 times, if not 10 out of 10 times, they will sort your problem out. If you find that you're not getting the cooperation and he's not doing what you think he has to do, then you have all the right to come to us. It's a mission. And explain what the issues are. We will then take the complaint forward. The procedure will be, you need to give us in writing. We will then tell the operator, give him a copy of the complaint. He has the right to reply to us in writing. And if you can come to an agreement, alhamdulillah. If not, we will get both parties there. try and see how we can find an amicable solution to sort this problem out. But the first person you need to contact is your operator. I hope and pray we don't have those issues, because I'm confident that the operators are quite capable of sorting out their problems. In Makkatul Mukarrama, our clinic is going to be at Ilaf Mashayir. We have already made arrangements for that. So it's quite centrally located. If you stand outside the Haram, what I would call so-called the old Aziz Kogir building, because I don't think people who haven't been there where the Safwa Towers is, if you stand there, you can see the building. So it's in very close proximity. The mission, as well as the medical, will both be placed at the same place. Then, obviously, depending on the type of packages you've bought, the movement now from Makkah to Azizia, 95%, in fact, I can safely say 99% of the South African Hajis moved to Azizia. That, depending on the contract, last year we had Hajis that moved on the 20th of Zilqaida. Some Hajis move on the 25th of Zilqaida. Some Hajis move at the end of Zilqaida. And we have a small number that moves on the 2nd and 3rd of Zilhajj. And we have an even smaller number that has a full stay in Makkah. Because the numbers are so small in Makkah, we don't facilitate any medical facilities after the 1st of Zilhajj in Makkah. The entire operation moves into Azizia. Again, we will be there to assist you with your movements into Azizia. There will be people there to assist you also in Azizia, which is quite normal. We will have a clinic in Azizia. We haven't confirmed where we're going to have it, but we have an inclination it's going to be centrally located, and we will notify the operators in good time so that you can use the facilities in Azizia. Now, this is especially for the young couples when it comes to Azizia. I think all of us, we know that in Azizia is the sharing facility. You have five men, five women in one room, or four men and four women in one room. That's how your package is structured. And then they also have facilities for couple rooms. Now, again, I'm not trying to say this in a derogatory manner or in a disrespectful manner, but this is the reality. The young couples, we recommend that if you can afford it, take couple rooms. A lot of frustration creeps in when the spouses cannot meet for whatever reason. I understand it's an extra cost. I understand it's expensive, but I think you need to assess that yourself. Each one's nature is different. Each one's conditions are different. But I can only make a recommendation based on the problems that we face in Azizia when it comes to young couples, and maybe even average couples. I don't know. It just depends on your financial capacity. If you can do that, it will be a recommendation that you try and get your own rooms. Otherwise, it's sharing facilities, and we need to understand that when we have to share, we need to be considerate, and we need to take into consideration the fellow Hajis. Then, I suppose the other big issue we have in Azizia is the toilets. Now, what I say about the toilets, you know, South Africans, we like toilet paper. In fact, some of the people even take toilet paper from South Africa to Saudi Arabia. There is toilet paper available in Saudi Arabia, by the way, for those people who take from South Africa. But when we go to toilet in Azizia, we want to fill the toilet with toilet paper. And it becomes a major problem for the people of the hotel, because the drainage facilities are not adequate for the amount of toilet. So use it sparingly. Use it in a manner that it doesn't clog up the toilets. Can you imagine using a clogged up toilet? So it's better if we take the precautions. I'm just mentioning this because we had too many issues, especially in the older, you know. In fact, a lot of the toilets actually got bins in the toilet where they say, use the toilet paper and throw it in the bin, not in the toilet pan. So again, that's just a precautionary thing. Come to the 5 days. This is now Hajj. This is now the crux. This is where we move to the Mashayir. On the 8th of Zilhajj, obviously the movements take place. Depending on the camps you're going to choose and where you're going to stay, I'm sure you must have already heard, or you must have made some investigations, that, you know, we have different camps on Mina. We have the special services, then we have the non-special services. Although I'm hearing from many operators that they don't want to use special services because it's become pretty expensive. pretty expensive. But I'm not going to discuss the prices. I think that's the job of the operator. Let him do that work for you. Be it as it may be, whichever camp you are going to be, we will be there. There'll be representatives at both the camps, like in the past. If you're going to all be in one camp, alhamdulillah, it will be absolutely fantastic. And I think, yes, South Africans, we need to show solidarity and stay together. But for whatever reasons, people do it differently, but that may be another issue to discuss at another time. So depending on which services you take, we will be there. We will facilitate your movement from Azizia into Mina, from Mina into Arafat, Arafat to Muzdalifah. I will explain that. Those people who are going to be in special services, unfortunately, you have to do own private arrangements with transportation. Those who are in non-special services, which is known as Camp B and Camp C, we have what we call a shuttle program system, which has been absolutely successful for the years that they have implemented it. In fact, many people from special services envy non-special services because of the shuttle program. It has worked absolutely magnificently. I just want to give you one example. The toughest journey in the years past was from Arafat to Muzdalifah. It used to take people between 8 and 14 hours to do a 9-kilometer stretch from Arafat to Muzdalifah. With the shuttle program, I can virtually, from experiences, guarantee, as much as I don't want to guarantee it because only Allah can guarantee things, maximum 30 minutes. Within 30 minutes, last year, an example, 9 o'clock, all South African Hajis from the non-special services were in Muzdalifah at 9 o'clock. So, yes, inshallah, that the shuttle program, we will come around to you in Saudi Arabia. I think it's too soon to talk about these things now, because if I'm going to tell you, I can guarantee you're going to forget what the procedures are going to be. We will come to your hotels. We will make arrangements with your operators, come and explain to you how this whole shuttle program system works. Again, I come back to my original statement. If we cooperate, we will be there to assist you, and I can guarantee you there's nothing to panic about. I have a slogan, don't fear when Sauk is there. So we'll be there, inshallah. Okay, so I've given you an outline about services and non-special services, depending on what you want to go for. Azizia, accommodation generally is good. Generally, there may be one or two issues, but I think you need to understand you're going to be coming from 5-star Medina, 5-star Makkah, then you're going to go to 2-star in Azizia. And then when you come to Mina, there's 0 stars. So I think you need to be mentally prepared for that, depending on the camps they're going to take you on. Okay, and the important thing is, you know, electrical situations are problematic on Arafat. I know all of us have those smartphones and, you know, we need chargers and all those type of things. We will try our best to facilitate. We've made recommendations to the Mu'assasa that they need to provide these points. But it does become problematic from time to time. But inshallah, we'll see how we can overcome the challenge. Muzdalifah. Now, depending on the contract, like our president said, if the operator sign a contract that is going to provide you a tent in Muzdalifah, come and talk to us. Because there's no tents in Muzdalifah. Muzdalifah is a difficult place. When I say difficult, it's for a couple of hours. It's an open ground. Year in and year out, we have issues with toilet facilities, lack of water, there's nothing to buy. So prepare yourself when you come from Arafat so that, you know, you don't have to. I know circumstantially sometimes people can't control themselves, but that's the reality. They have facilities, but the crowd is just too big. And sometimes the condition they leave the facility, you probably mess yourself before you go into the toilet. But that is Muzdalifah. It's going to be for a couple of hours. You need to sleep there for a couple of hours and then move on. So yes, as far as walking is concerned, walking Hajj, we totally, totally, I mean totally discourage it. I'm not saying you mustn't do it. I'm saying we discourage it. The conditions that are prevailing currently makes it very difficult for South Africans. You know, we as South Africans, even in our own homes, if you want to go to the toilet, we need a car. Now, If you're not used to those type of situations, it becomes very difficult. The heat, you know, we don't hydrate ourselves, and especially the ladies. We have this problem year in and year out. They don't want to drink because they fear to use the toilets in Mina, because they've heard so much about it. So they will rather dehydrate themselves and then become a problem for themselves. So we need to understand that the walking Hajj is really problematic. If you have the stature, the physical stature, by all means, go ahead and do it. But I can tell you, it's going to be taxing and it's going to be difficult with degrees of 50 and above expected for this current Hajj. I remember many years ago, and I'm talking of 1989, when I went for Hajj in 89, it was 55. We had to put people into a cold room to keep them alive. But those are things that we discourage. Again, I know there are some that think differently, but alhamdulillah, that's your choice. But it does become a bit of a problem for us from a maintenance point of view. Now, you find a lot of people, when they do the walking Hajj, they expect Sahuk to be on a 24-hour call. And that's virtually impossible. We are 26 people with 2,000 Hajjis. It's going to be, we are at strategic points. We can't be at your back at every given time. Yes, if you are there, we will assist you. Now, sometimes something goes wrong, the first blame goes to Sauk. Where's Sauk? They say they got a medical facility here, but you are somewhere between Arafat and Muzdalifah. Now, what, you expect Sauk to be there as well? It doesn't work. It's not going to happen. But if you come to Muzdalifah, they will be there. If you come to Arafat, they will be there. In fact, by law, according to the Hajj Ministry, we're not supposed to operate a medical facility in the Mashayir. Mashayir is Mina, Arafat, Muzdalifah. But we have taken the initiative in private negotiations with the Muassasa that we will provide this facility in a very discreet manner. A lot of times you'll see the doctor taking out the tablets from his pocket. Now you're thinking, what kind of a doctor is this? It's not the question of what kind of a doctor he is. It is because of the restrictions that have been placed by the Hajj Ministry for us not to operate a medical facility. So to facilitate your needs, he takes out the tablet from his pocket and gives it to you. So don't look at it as a omen, but in reality, a facilitation. Now, the other thing that I want to talk generally about is, you know, traveling in Mecca. People think that, you know, it's 100% safe, it's secure, there's no issues. Ladies want to take their own taxis and go to Azizia, do the shopping here and there. It is not as safe as what we think. We need to take the precautions. Ladies should not travel on their own. They should have their mahrams with them, have company with them. There's many incidences that have taken place. And they say, you know, in Afrikaans, spijt kom achter. Regret only comes afterwards. So let's avoid that type of situation. Now, I just want to mention one thing that we want to implement this year, and obviously we need the cooperation of you as Hajjis. We've been toying on this idea of having survey forms given out to the Hajjis. So we want to do this year. And the only way this can be successful, if you are going to give us your honest opinion so that we can improve the services in the future. Now, I know some people are going to throw the survey forms back in our faces. We're quite prepared for that. But wherever you can assist us, please do that. Okay, now I'm going to go on to the medical because I've been given the task to just give you a bit of an outline as far as what the medical is all about, because Dr. Akil unfortunately has another commitment and he won't be coming. Daily walks, I mean, this I'm reading out from the notes that he's made, daily walks, and the idea for the daily walks is to keep yourself physically fit. I must tell you that Sahuk is toying with this idea for the future. If you can do it this year, I would actually be pleased. That every Haji has to provide a medical certification before he goes on Hajj. The reason for that, people have this tendency that if I got stage 5 cancer, I have the right to be on Hajj. If I'm a sick person almost about to die, I have the first right to go on Hajj. Then I think we haven't learned the rules of Hajj. Speak to the ulama, and really, Sahuk is looking at this very seriously for the future. that the Haji will have to provide a medical clearance certificate before he's going to be accredited, or her. For the simple reason, medical facilities are being put under tremendous strain in Saudi Arabia. I need to make this one thing. If people got preconditions and they think they're going to go to Saudi and get a bypass done, or they got a problem and they think that the Saudi authorities are going to do it, they're not going to touch you. What they will do is they will stabilize you and tell you to go home. Yes, if you came there healthy and you got a heart attack, they will spend R1 million on you. They will go all the way. The condition is, don't come with the precondition. And these people who are sick, I don't know, people misconstrue it and say, you know what, this guy is now telling us not to come for Hajj. Who's he? Has he become Allah now? He decides who must go for Hajj. That's not the argument. There are rules and regulations, and these are stipulated in Sharia. We need to be of good health and, you know, financial stability and all those things before we go on Hajj. So you can't just think, because first of all, if a cancer patient comes there, there's no oncology in Saudi Arabia. They don't have the facility for that. So you become a burden to the people who are with you, you become a burden to the operator, you become a burden to the medical thing. Similarly with other issues. So people, if you've got a precondition, firstly, notify us. Notify your operator. For example, dialysis patients. You need to tell us about this so that we can make adequate arrangements before you land so that we can have the dialysis done. They do that for us. But if you do it last minute, it becomes very difficult. So I need you people to understand that, you know, preconditioning is a no-go in Saudi Arabia. And financially, Saudi Arabia is under tremendous strain. The medical fraternity, we had a meeting now when we were there in Saudi with a lady who does this mass gathering sort of research and things like that. And they mentioned that it's becoming very costly to maintain. They will do what they have to do. A lot of people have objection, why Sahu got a clinic there? But inshallah, when you get there for Hajj, you will realize why Sahuk has a clinic. And it is a requirement of the protocol that Sahuk needs to provide these facilities in the kingdom. Although it is purely a primary health care. The other important thing is that I think the president spoke about the sandals. Like I said, you buy a 50,000 rand package, and then you want a 5 rand sandal, and then you want to make a good Hajj. It's not going to work. Have a good pair of shoes so that, you know, you are comfortable, and I think that's the most important thing. Ladies, you know, there's a tendency that black is the color. Ladies just want to wear black. It's problematic on the mashayir. Go for white. Black absorb heat. White will repel it. So these are factors that we've noticed. Spray bottles. Carry spray bottles and spray yourself continuously with that. The walking Hajj I've told you about. Hydration, I think the president has spoken about. We can't speak enough about this. On the 5 days alone last year, we used 200 drips. We had to drip 200 people, all because of dehydration. A lot of people come to Arafat and they say they want to go to Jabal Rahmah. The last couple of years, our camp was very close to Jabal Rahmah. Yes, go to Jabal Rahmah, but it's hot. When they come back from Jabal Rahmah, they go to Jabal Rahmah to make dua. When they come back from Jabal Rahmah, we have to make dua for them. Because they totally buggered. So please, take those things into consideration because it is a major challenge. And to carry those 200 drips, it's a task. Believe you me. And we have to physically carry them because they don't allow transportation on the mashayir unless you have a 20-seater bus. And we don't have a 20-seater bus. So the mission members actually carry that from Azizia into Mina, from Mina into Arafat to facilitate the Hujjaj. So dehydration is going to be a major issue. Masks, We're asking people to wear masks. As you know, there's a lot of construction taking place in Saudi Arabia, in Makkah al-Mukarramah. So depending on the sensitivity, last year we had a lot of problems with chest problems where people couldn't breathe because of the dust factor and things like that. So I think we need to take that into consideration. Primary healthcare. Now, we do primary healthcare. Yes, we've received accolades from the medical facilities in Saudi Arabia. They've given us a AAA rating for the type of facilities that we provide for the Hujjaj. We take medication from South Africa in excess of R500,000. We take with us, which we give out to the patients for the requirements, at no charge, by the way. And we will facilitate non-chronic conditions. Now, there are people that got heart medication and they high blood pressure tablets and all those type of things. Those are chronic medication. You need to carry that with you. Sahuk don't provide chronic medication. The demands become absolutely phenomenal. Even after telling the people that we don't provide for this, they will come there and demand it. We are there to assist you. Clinic times are from 9 o'clock in the morning till Zohar Azan. From Zohar Azan, after Zohar Namaz, 2 o'clock we open up again till Asr. Between Asr and Maghrib, is closed. After Isha we open till 10 o'clock. But don't come there at Azan time and expect to be treated. As much as Namaz is compulsory on you, it is compulsory on the mission members as well. And people come there, and if you tell them, please come after namaz, they get upset. And I think it's not fair. Number two, because the treatment is free, people tend to take advantage. Now, you've got people who have diabetic or who have pressure problems. There's 50 people sitting in a clinic, and the guy will come and demand, take my blood pressure. Now, you know, in Gujarati, there's a very good saying. I don't know if people understand Gujarati, but I'll explain it to you in English. They say chilies that you get for free is not strong. And this is basically what it is. Because the facility is free, the guy will come there and he'll demand to have his blood pressure checked every day. It's not that we have a problem. When the clinic is quiet, when the other patients are gone, we prepare to do that. But don't come and demand. We had a haji last year or the year before that used to come for an injection every day. And there's a trend. I don't know what's happening these days. You know, the B12. There's this whole thing about B12 injection. The guys will come there before going on the 5 days, because they've been told they must come for a B12 injection because the B12 injection gives them vuma. It's a myth, believe you me. I'm telling you this so that you can ask your doctor before you come there. We will give it to you. But, you know, let's be reasonable. Let's be realistic. That is why mental and physical condition is important rather than coming there and demanding injections one after the other. Insulin, like the president mentioned, is not available in Saudi Arabia. So you've got to make sure that you take enough with you. All medication that you carry, which is Schedule 5 and above, you need to take a doctor's letter with you. You need to bring it in its original packaging. If you bring it in doctor's packets, it's not sufficient. They're getting stricter and stricter. So cover yourselves. Make sure that you have the necessary proof that you are on this medication so you don't have problems at the airport. Again, like I mentioned, divide your medication up into different bags so that in case it gets lost, you know, you don't have a problem. Medicine names change. You know, you have a medicine here that's a different name, it's a different name there. So if you have the original packaging, we can facilitate to see how we can get the comparator for the compatible one or the generic one. People who have allergies, you know, people who got high blood problem, penicillin, this, you have to change. Please wear them, because it makes it easy for us to know whether you need penicillin or you can't give you penicillin. Those are important things. And obviously, prepare yourself for the 5 days. Unfortunately, we do so much of walking before the 5 days. When the 5 days come, we are out for the count. And in reality, the 5 days is actual Hajj. Whatever you do in Medina, whatever you do in Makkah is a consolation. But the actual Hajj is the 5 days. Ziyarats, yes, by all means, do the ziyarats. We don't have a problem. But now all of a sudden, the guys become so great machos, they want to climb Jabal Nur. They can't even climb this hill here, but they want to go and climb Jabal Nur. Then what happens? When they come back, the muscles are sore, the back is sore, the hands are sore, and it becomes a mission or a medical problem. Now, we don't provide massage facilities as far as the clinic is concerned. But I think we need to take adequate precautions so that we don't create strain on ourselves. I think I've probably taken more time than I supposed to. But I think whatever information I've given, alhamdulillah, is relevant to what is going to happen on Hajj. And inshallah al-Aziz, if you take notes of this and you to adhere to this, I'm sure you will remember me, what I have said. More importantly, you remember me in your du'as, and I make du'a, ki Allah grant you Hajj Mabrur, Hajj Maqbool. Jazakallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You've listened to the rest, now listen to the best. I'm not blowing my own trumpet. I've been given 1 hour and 8 minutes. How are you all? You look all tired and exhausted. The best part of this particular show is the Q&A which you have come here for. Very, very important. Even if that question you think sounds stupid, please don't be shy to ask, because this is your time to say what you want to say. You heard the president, you heard the mission, you heard everybody, and you don't listen to my crap now. But listen, let us just give you about 10 minutes, Chief. No, we're cutting it short. We'll give you 10 minutes for Q&A. You can pose a question to anyone here. Let's start here. Okay, there's a roving mic. We'll hear, there's Zain there, Sheikh Zain. Let us take three at a time. We'll take three questions at a time. Who's the first one? Who's the second one? Just remember, who's the third one? Okay, right. Bismillah.
One. Assalamu alaikum. With the recent halal and haram issues in Makkah and Medina and the meat stories, will it be possible for Sahuk to give a list of like places to eat that are like not so...
not so haram.
Okay, I was number two.
Yes.
I was wondering, you know, there were supposed to be trains from Mecca to Medina. Are the, you know, is the infrastructure done, and will it be available when we actually go for Hajj, inshallah?
Alhamdulillah. The third one?
I would like to know on the point system, if you got 80 points, where do you stand in the queue?
Is that fine?
Yeah.
Just like that. Yes, Chief.
Can we just switch this mic on?
It is on.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I think first thing we'll answer the halal, haram issue. A very difficult question, you know, from a perspective for Sahuk to actually guide you into which restaurants you must go to. But generally, we've been informed that you try to stay away from some of the more generic restaurants, you know, your Burger Kings and the likes of those. There's obviously local Pakistani restaurants and, you know, places that you can eat at. And alhamdulillah, the last week that we were there in Safwa Towers, in Abraj, in the Hyatt complex, there's sufficient food places that are permissible to eat at. The lady asked about trains. The infrastructure is being constructed. According to news reports out of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, these trains were scheduled to come on stream by the end of 2016, so they will not be available for Hajj this year. And judging by what we've seen insofar as infrastructure is concerned, I think there could be a delay, given the economic situation and given the fund situation from that point there. Insofar as the gentleman's question regarding 80 points, 80 points indicates that you are a repeat pilgrim, because only persons with 100 points are considered for Hajj accreditation at this particular point in time. And the specific reason for that is because of the scarcity of visas and the scarcity of quota that has been presented on South Africa. So 80 points is still quite far down the queue insofar as that is concerned. Understand that inshallah, if we do end up getting an increase, and you know, we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He does allow for us to get maybe 6,000 or 7,000, we can then split the quota into two factors. And this is something that is not yet concretely cast in stone, but we split the quota into two sectors, where we will have a quota for first-time pilgrims, and then we will look at the repeat pilgrims as well, so as to give everybody an equal opportunity. But that can only be done once we have a quota that is substantive enough to be able to facilitate that. Jazakallah. Some more questions from the
floor?
Some
more questions?
There's a gentleman there.
Hold on. Who's first?
The gentleman there.
You first.
Yeah.
Next.
Yeah. Yeah. Second. The uncle here in front. Next.
Second and third.
Okay. There's a lady there. Across with the pink
okay,
scarf. Right? Bismillah.
Number one.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum
wa rahmatullah.
I actually have two questions for the panel, both related to the accreditation. Firstly, I'd like to find out what range of dates are you looking at for accreditation? Because currently, if I look at the registration list, there are people there from 2009. So if you could give us an indication of that, we could see where we fit in. And then also with regard to the releasing of the accreditation lists, I know you mentioned that the first list would be released around the 24th.
After.
Or after the 24th of April. Give us an indication of when the second list and third lists would be released post that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Second question, uncle in the front.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Mr. Chairman, I've got a few questions for you. You know, the first thing you mentioned, you said you're not prepared to allow anybody to jump the queue.
Yes.
Now, then you gave us an example of pick and pay. You have 50 guys standing there, you're the 51st person. Now, if you go to the bank and you see 100 guys standing there, there's a little board that shows there that disabled guys, elderly guys, people who are not well, they can go straight to the counter.
Uh-huh.
But yet, Chauk is not prepared to assist anybody. You've got to stand and wait for your turn. Then again, we have a gentleman here says, we will assist you in every way. Then we have you saying, you've got to stand in the queue and we're not prepared to assist anybody, you must wait for your turn. Then you have this gentleman telling us that very shortly they're going to be introducing a system where you will have to supply a medical certificate to say that you're fit. Now I've got I'm physically disabled. About 4 or 5 years ago, I went for Umrah. I couldn't even complete the Safa Marwa. And then the guy pitched up here with a wheelchair and said, give me 200 rands and I'll push you and get it done for you. So the army subsidy for nothing.
Okay.
Okay, so what I'm trying to tell you is that we're reaching an age, we're 70 years old, man. Just now at 75, you never know what happens. I've got diabetes.
Thank you, uncle. I understand the point that you're making. Let's give someone else a chance to answer. And I will answer the question to you right now. Lady?
Assalamu alaikum.
Salam.
About this medication you said we should put in different luggages.
Just put it on the mic.
Is it, will it be possible? Am I not
talking? Would it be possible?
Can't we rather just carry all our medication in our handbags, in hand luggage?
Okay, and, let's just ask that. In fact, if you don't mind, let me answer that question first. Right? Medication in hand luggage and in your overnight check-in luggage is permitted, as long as you don't have a bottle of liquid more than 100 milliliters. If you're carrying your tablets and everything in your hands, that's not a problem. As long as, like Hafiz Ismail said and I said earlier, anything Schedule 5 and above, you have the necessary doctor's letters in form and you've got it in the original packaging. No issue with that. That is fine. Your next question before I go on to the others.
we spoke about the water. Oh.
Yeah, keep it closer to your sister.
We spoke about this water bottle that you can't carry, but it's also hand lotions.
Yes, correct. Any
tubes.
Liquid.
Yeah, you can't take that either.
Any aerosols, any liquid, or anything more than 100 milliliters. So if you look at the product, if you look at, for example, you know, we use underarms. If that has got 100 mils or 125 mils, you've got a problem. Anything with codeine as well, you cannot carry on you. Because codeine is obviously a banned substance and a banned drug in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. So these are things that you need to be considerate about and understand. We can obviously discuss various other things, you know, one-on-one if you need to have that.
One more last one. Is will it be advisable to carry our copies of our documents?
It's most important that you carry copies of every document, your passport and your visa. So in other words, if you're traveling with your spouse, the wife keeps the husband keeps the wife's. You keep a copy in each bag as well. Just in the event that something unfortunate goes wrong, you either get, you know, it gets lost or whatever. But alhamdulillah, from the Muassasa's point of view, they have never lost anybody's passport. We've had a situation where a woman was given back a passport. She cleared immigration in Jeddah. And once she got inside immigration, she lost her bag. And she lost her passport. She boarded the flight to South Africa without documents. It became a major problem here in South Africa because she didn't have copies of the documents. Jazakallah for your questions. Right, the gentleman in the back, release of the disc. The date range is very simple. Our system registration is perpetual. So you can decide which year you want to apply in. The date range that you see on the system currently are people who in 2009, 10, 11, and 12 had applied for the year 2016 or 1437 Hijri year date. And that is why you see them being queued in that particular order. And our system is based on those kind of silos. So it doesn't really work on a system where if I'm applying today and I apply for 1440, so in 1439, somebody applies it for 1440 as well. Naturally, in terms of date and time priority, I'm ahead of that person in the queue because my date of application is today. You with me? And that is basically the process upon which this registration was created. I can explain it to you in more detail, you know, a little bit later. The release of the list is based on when the auditor will complete the audit of the system and the process. We are targeting the 24th of April, inshallah. Once that list is audited and complete, we will then release the list and give 2 weeks for people to accept their accreditation. Why are we having these roadshows now? So that you can see from a perspective of where you are in the queue and take the necessary packages, go and study it so that when you are accredited, you can accept accreditation on an informed source. You've got your information at hand. You know that if you're in the first 2,000, inshallah, you are going to be accredited this year. That is basically what one needs to look at, right? Again, as I mentioned earlier, it is a dynamic list at the moment where changes are made based on queries that are received by SAWQ from prospective hujjaj in the community. And we need to appreciate and understand that. We've stopped last year accrediting people in the middle of September. We're talking about 12-13 September 2012. So anybody between 2009 and September 2012 are people who applied specifically for this year. And then the carryover comes through from last year's remainder list, and we continue from there. That is how the queue is determined and how the process is played out. The gentleman talks about jumping the queue in the front. People, let me explain the different permutations to you. We have tried in 2008 to do an age-based permutation. Now, uncle says he's nearly 70 years old. At what basis do you determine when someone is old? Do you determine if it's 65, if it's 70, 75, 80, or 85? Now you ask somebody who's 50 years old, or 40 years old, or 30 years old, who determines when is your time to die? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala determines that. Who determines your health? Hajj is based on al-manistata'a, and the ulama will be able to explain that to us later. Manistata'a, in my understanding and according to the ulama that I have spoken to, is not a necessity from a funding perspective, from a financial perspective. It is from a physical and a mental perspective as well. That is manistata'a. Making yourself 100% and completely ready for this journey in terms of what was explained, the physical hardships and everything else that goes with it. And I sympathize with you and I understand your point, uncle.
But the minute you start changing the permutation and saying we're going to bring aged people and give them the preference, you have a problem. In 2008, we had one Hajj operator with 56 Hujjaj. Out of that 56 Hujjaj, 48 of them required to be pushed in a wheelchair. Where is the natural support within groups? There are groups that take over 500, there are groups that take over 200, there are groups that take over 100, 150. And there's a mix of young and old Hujjaj. And the camaraderie that you find in Makkah from a perspective of support is phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. And hence one looks at that natural support in order to balance out the process. Last year, we had 395 people over the age of 65 that went for Hajj from South Africa. Now, out of 2,000, that's quite a significant number. We can't turn around and say we're going to give the age first because then no young people are going to go for Hajj. So one needs to appreciate that we've looked at other systems around the world and everybody, Malaysia, Indonesia, all of them work on date and time priority. The only country that we have found that works on an age-based criteria is Jordan. Jordan and Iran. Iran will only start giving people accreditation for Hajj at the age of 81 and Jordan at the age of 65. I hope that answered the question, inshallah. Jazakallah. Are there any other questions? Lady at the back and then another lady in the front and the gentleman, yeah. Okay, the lady here, and then we've got two more ladies and then this gentleman. Ma'am?
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu
alaikum. I applied for my accreditation on the 2nd of January 2013.
Right.
That's my first time that I will be performing my Hajj. But unfortunately, my parents have been for Hajj in 84 already.
Yes.
When do you require that I would be eligible to go for my first time Hajj?
Ma'am, are you queued with your parents or separate from your parents?
With my parents.
Then you need to de-link from your parents. You need to read our FAQs, our rules of application, and our frequently asked questions, which explains the whole process of application. If you have a combination of family members where there are people in the family group that have made Hajj before, and a person that hasn't made Hajj before, the points are averaged and that brings the points down, which renders you ineligible. But if you separate from that group, and you basically de-link yourself from that group. Because remember, the queue is based on first-time pilgrims only. The repeat pilgrims, unfortunately, whilst we have a scarcity of quota, will not be able to make Hajj in the immediate future.
So then what do I do with the mahram? Do I still have my father as my mahram?
You can
and
have your father.
My mother?
You can have your father as your mahram and de-link your mother. Alternatively, the Hanafi madhab requires that females must have a mahram. Shafi, Maliki and Hanbali madhab, according to the kingdom and the rules of the kingdom of Saudi Arabia, a female over the age of 45 traveling in a group does not require a mahram.
Okay, but it's my privilege.
It's your prerogative. It's your prerogative. Yes. Absolutely. Thank you, sister. The lady in the back with the black scarf there, please. And we're coming to the gentleman in a short while.
Assalamu
alaikum. Wa alaikum
salam. Mulana, just as a statement also to reiterate what the Mulana, I think Musa said earlier about medication, I'd just like to inform all the Hujjaj who are here that when you have your medication, you have a trade name, and you have a chemical name, okay? So we as medical representatives, we always prefer, especially when you travel internationally, to please make a list of your chemical name. So if you're looking at your drug like glucophage, which is a very common one, you make a list of your name called metformin, because that is the name that we as pharmacists or doctors and such will be able to understand, and we'll be able to give you any drug with the trade name, wherever in the world it is. So instead of advising to take the original packaging material, you should rather advise to use those names. So for example, Panado is paracetamol. Okay, so always advise that because that's the easiest way that works.
Thank you, sister. Appreciate that.
Okay, and my other question to you is that when you spoke about earlier about your when you applied for Hajj, okay, and you said for those who had applied in 2009, whether they had actually wanted to be in 2016. For example, those who had applied in for the year 2015,
yes,
but did not get accredited in 2015, but they are first-time Hajis, all right? How does that work, and who gets priority over that for 2016? And the reason I'm asking is because last year I had applied for 2015. I'm a first-time Haji. My points had somehow gone to 80. When I checked on the system last year, it had moved to 80. So we picked up the phone and called Sahuk, and the operator who had answered the phone couldn't explain why. And she said, look, I'm changing it to 100. Alhamdulillah, it's changed to 100 as it stands today. All right? But I just wanted to find out then, in that case, if I've applied for 2015, didn't get accredited, and the person has applied for 2016, which one of us would be the preference to fill
what
your
date,
quota?
What date was your application made on, sister?
April 2013.
Right. So a person who applies in 2009 has preference over you in terms of date and time priority. Am I correct?
Okay.
And that is basically how it works. So any, as much as you've applied in 2013 for 2015, and you didn't get accredited in 2015 due to the scarcity of quota, because the quota stopped in September 2012. That was the cutoff date by which we accredited the last person. Anyone who is rolled over according to their original date of application. So April 2013 is when you will be queued. But people who have applied 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012 for this year will be ahead of you in the queue. That is how the system is based. And that is basically how we roll it on going forward, inshallah.
Okay.
Thank you so much. We have the gentleman here, and then I'm going to come to the lady in the front.
Hi, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
If you're sitting with 100 points,
yes.
How will you know what number you are in the queue?
If you go onto the website today, we have a registration list today that gives you your number and your place in the queue. There's over 17,000 persons that are listed there, and you'll be able to see whether you are number 1 or number 15,000 or number 2,000. It's on our website.
Jazakallah.
Khayakallah. Just give me a second. Let the lady, the lady was ahead of you. There's a lady in the front here that asked the question. Raise your hand, please.
Which lady is it? This is the lady?
Yeah, just remember one other thing before the lady, that your position in the queue is not guaranteed accreditation until the accredited list is out. I mentioned that earlier, it's a dynamic list and will only become a finite and fixed list once we release the accreditation of 2,000 people. Ma'am?
What happens, assalamu alaikum, what happens if a woman received accreditation a couple of years ago and her mahram, who was supposed to have taken her at that time, passed away, so she was unable to go for Hajj? Now she has a mahram who's been accredited. Can she then use that previous accreditation to go with her mahram now?
Ma'am, if you are queued in the system and you don't have a mahram, you can have the mahram registered today, because the rules of the mahram is very simple. A female is entitled to a mahram and she pulls him up the queue to join her. That is a fiqh rule. That is not a sawq rule. That is according to Sharia. Okay, so there is no problem with regards to utilizing the old application, as long as you didn't go and as long as you didn't notify Saud. You did notify Saud. Because remember, if you did not notify Saud and your accreditation was cancelled at that time, you are then going to be void of 30 points. So your points will then be 70 on that application system. You now need to then, in order to get 100 points, reapply as a person with a mahram, and you will then be drop to the bottom of the queue. The reason for that is so as not to prejudice people in the queue, where people come and say, oh no, you cancelled me, but why didn't you accept the accreditation? Oh, I changed my phone number. So whose fault is that? Is that Saud's fault that you changed your phone number, or is it your fault that you didn't notify Saud? Therefore, I urge all of you, when accreditation comes through, okay, and you are not going to go for Hajj, notify, in fact, you don't even need to notify Saud. Because on the system, you can determine whether you want to transfer to next year or whether you want to transfer to a year of your choice. You as the accredited pilgrim, you can do that. But if you don't understand it, then get in touch with Sauk and say, I'm not going for Hajj this year. Please transfer me to next year or transfer me to the following year. That way we will make sure that you retain your place in the queue with your points. But if you don't tell Sauk, and in the 2 weeks that that particular accreditation process has run its course, we cancel your accreditation. You lose 30 points. And you will not then be allowed to gain that 30 points back because you have failed to inform or come forward to Sauk on that basis. Please understand that.
Jazakallah for all the questions and answers. Yes, we will take questions and answers after 12 o'clock because we've got Radio Islam live with us at this moment, and I'm going to call up after Radio Islam, once we bid farewell to them, then we will go back to question and answers. I'm going to call upon a media partner, representative from Radio Islam, a man who needs no introduction, and I'm sure many of the brothers and sisters listen to this man on a Sunday morning very early. And when I say very early, because he doesn't sleep before Fajr already, and he can't sleep. So what happens, he has a program on a Sunday morning, also very early. And I think so there's a program that he runs called Marriage on Air sometimes. And this is a man that talks about marriage. And I'm going to call upon Maulana Habib Bobat to say a few words to us. And from his wisdom, we can hear and we can learn a lot from his wisdom. This is a very wise young man, let me say to you. Because when you listen to him and when he starts translating from Arabic and that, then you'll know about the wisdom about Maulana Habib Bobat. And surely when he speaks about marriage, it's full of wisdom. So today he's going to speak about Hajj, and we're going to ask him to speak and give us some advices from his wisdom.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I understand it's a lengthy session and it has been a very long waiting period also. So I'm going to request you to all stand up just quickly, mashallah. Let's just loosen up a little bit, mashallah. Mashallah. Just be careful of the person next to you, just now you hit him. Mashallah. Sit down, mashallah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وبعد. Proper preparation prevents poor performance. Proper preparation prevents poor performance. I mean, you've been saving up for such a long period. You put away a lump sum to go out for Hajj. And then you go to the Holy Lands. The last thing you want is poor performance. And in any field of life, preparation is utmost important. You cannot expect a person, take him from his home and put him on the sporting field and expect him to perform at his optimum level. It's just not going to happen. There's a process behind the process. There's rigorous training taking place behind all the sporting arenas and behind all the sporting games. They are preparing for the final moment when they are getting onto the field. Hajj is the epic journey of every believer's life. And you want to maximize every moment when you are there. And for that requires preparation. And that's what I'm going to be addressing you today. I'm going to be focusing on three areas. Firstly, on preparation before Hajj. Secondly, your travel to the Holy Lands. And thirdly, whilst you are at the Holy Land, how to maximize. So as far as preparations are concerned, the first thing, when you are accredited, the first thing you do is to read 2 rakat salat al-shukr. It is Allah who has chosen you. It is Allah who has accredited you. Earlier on, you heard Brother Shaheen Esop alluding to the fact that people in Malaysia wait several years just to be accredited. And many people are only accredited in their advanced ages. In South Africa, alhamdulillah, the process is quite faster than that. So you need to be thankful to the Almighty Allah that Allah has hand-chosen you. Allah has hand-chosen you. It's not by coincidence. Allah has taken you out to see His holy lands. You must be appreciative of that fact. Secondly, make sure you go on halal earnings. Every cent that you spent should be from halal and pure income. إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى طَيِّبٌ وَلَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا الطَّيِّبُ Allah is pure and Allah only accepts that which is pure and wholesome. Thirdly, if you are a debtor, you're owing somebody money, make sure that you settle those accounts before you leave for Hajj. If you are unable to settle your accounts, speak to your creditors, inform them that you are going for Hajj. I'll tell you, I was doing the program on the radio, and you find people calling on the radio live, Molana, leave all these stories. These people that go for Hajj, they owe us money in the thousands, and today they're crying at the multism. How is Allah going to accept the du'as? On live radio. So, we strongly advise that if you are unable to settle your debts, go to the person. Try to amicably come to an agreement. When I return, inshallah, first priority is your debt. Moving on to the spiritual aspect. Your Hajj starts the minute you are accredited. Your Hajj does not start on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah. Please get that right. And in terms of spiritual preparation, the first thing that you need to do is to read a good book on Hajj. You don't have to be at the mercy of the Hajj guide, where he has to guide you at every moment of your journey. You can be self-sufficient. I strongly advise that you read the book of Hazrat Sheikh Zakaria Rahmatullah Alayhi on the fadail and the virtues of Hajj. You'll have a different outlook to Hajj when you go to the Holy Lands. So buy a good book on Hajj. I strongly recommend the book of Hazrat Sheikh Zakaria Rahmatullah Alayhi on the virtues of Hajj. Secondly, get into the spiritual routine now already. Don't expect to go to the Holy Lands and all of a sudden you just go into the spiritual mode. It's not going to happen. You're going to burn out in 1 day or 2 days maximum. You need to prepare in advance. Get into the spiritual routine. Get into the routine of reciting Quran now already. Try to make at least one khatam before you leave for Hajj. Because you are preparing yourself. And once you mentally prepare yourself, you are able to maximize from your stay when you are in the Holy Lands. Moving on, get into the routine of making dua. You will not find Makkah in Lanesia. You will not find Makkah in Bosman, and definitely not in Fordsburg. That is the most holiest land in the world. Makkah al-Mukarrama and Madinah al-Munawwara. People are envious to go there. You are there. So maximize from the environment. Lift your hands in front of Allah. Converse with Him on a regular basis. Minimum your dua should be 10 minutes. And trust me, if you're not in the routine of making dua now, your dua will not be more than 2 minutes when you're in the Holy Lands. Prepare yourself. Have a checklist. Eventually, you will be so geared up that you will not have a checklist when you are making dua. But for now, start with a checklist. Dua for yourself, your parents, your family, your siblings, your children, your community, the ummah at large. Have a routine and have a pattern of making dua. So when you are at the Holy Lands, you are able to maximize from there. And lastly, when it comes to spirituality, try to take some books with you when you are at the Holy Lands, because it's easy to get caught up with friends and other people and to waste your time away and not benefit at all. It brings me to the end of the first part of my discussion. The second part, whilst you are traveling to your Holy Lands, you are going from Johannesburg to Jeddah or Medina to Munawwara, wherever it may be, please remember, you have to perform salah whilst you're on the plane. Allah has not made it ma'af for you. It does not fall off in the plane. It's extremely important that you start your journey on a positive note. If you are going to say, when I return, inshallah, I'll change my life, that's not going to happen. Your journey starts now already. Once you embark, make sure that you perform your salah timeously. Number one. Number two, keep calm and lower your gaze. You can get caught very quickly in this. It's like, mashallah. No, you got your wife with, you've got your mahram with. Lower your gaze. You are going to the Holy Lands for a spiritual reformation. It's not good to start off on such negative note where you are looking at the opposite gender and you are scanning them left to right and top to bottom. It's not befitting of a believer, especially a person who's going to visit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whilst you are halting in Dubai or wherever it may be, make sure that you are performing your salah and make sure that you are not caught up on the wrong side when it comes to sinning, etc. Start your journey on a spiritual note. That's all I'm saying. It brings me to the third part of my discussion. When you are at the Holy Lands, the first thing that you need to do is recoup. Allow your body to rest. Allow your body to recover from that long, arduous journey. Allow yourself to recoup. That's the first thing. Don't go out there with that josh and that enthusiasm. I'm going there. You're going to burn out very quickly. Be wise in your approach. So number one, recoup. The second thing that you do, take note of the salah times in the haram. You paid a lump sum to go to the Holy Lands. You're not going to get the Kaaba in Lanesia and Bosman and Fordsburg. It's only one Kaaba, and that is in Makkatul Mukarramah. It's foolish of you to read your salah in your hotels. I mean, you're right there. You're right there, and you're performing salah in your hotel. So make a note of the salah times. There are six azans in the Holy Lands. The additional azan goes out at the time of the Hajjud. Do not get confused. That's not the azan for Fajr. That is a different azan. So make a note of your salah times. That's very important. Then, have a timetable. Have a timetable. A believer is organized. The Prophet ﷺ was organized. He was systematic in his approach. So work with a timetable. I usually advise the Hujjaj that have a spiritual activity after each fard salah. So after Fajr, perhaps you want to read some Quran. After Dhuhr, you want to read some kitab reading. After Asr, you want to read some dhikr. You want to make some dhikr. After Maghrib, you want to make some dua. After Isha, you want to read some durood or whatever. So that your soul is not bored. Diversity creates interest to the soul, and it makes it easier for the soul to be uplifted throughout the day. If you are going to go with a vibe, I'm going to finish one Quran in one night, trust me, you won't even reach the 10th para, and you'll close it for the rest of your journey. If you're going to space yourself out, you allow room for sleeping, for resting, you're allowing yourself the room to do different things at different times, you will, inshallah, benefit from your journey. And lastly, when you are there, make ample dua. Ample dua. This is the minimum. Make ample dua wherever you are. People who are struggling to find a partner in life, that's the time to ask. People who are battling financially, that's the time to ask. People who are having problems in their marriages, that's the time to ask. Whatever problem you've got, you will not find a setup like that. I mean, in the millions that I have gathered there, definitely there's someone that Allah looks at favorably. Definitely there's someone that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks with a favorable eye. There are weak people. There are elderly people. There are frail people. Because of whom Allah will accept your du'as. And there are so many other pious servants of Allah. In that multitude of people, Allah will accept your du'a also. And remember us back at home and make du'a for the ummah. For we are going through a very challenging time. May the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward us all. And may Allah accept all your hajj and all your efforts inshaAllah. Remember, it's the first or the last time. You never know whether you'll get another chance or not. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam. Maulana, jazakallah khairul jaza for the words of wisdom. And we have come to the end of our program, the streaming and the live broadcast with Radio Islam. We want to thank all the listeners of Radio Islam International, wherever you are in the world. We say Jazakallah for listening to us. We say we request you from Fordsburg, Johannesburg, South Africa, we request your du'as that we have in this Hajj awareness program. We have Hujjaj al-Kiram who are eagerly waiting for the accreditation. We beg you around the world, wherever you are listening to us on any audio stream, video stream, or via satellite or DSTV, we request you to make dua for all of us. And once again, on behalf of the South African Hajj and Umrah Council, I want to bid farewell to the listeners of Radio Islam International. Jazakallah, Maulana Bobat.
I just want to say a few things that Maulana Bobad has touched on. And when he said that you must ask by the Kaabatullah, the first thing he said, that you want a partner, you must ask there. Because this is his forte. This is what he speaks about. So Maulana, that's it. When you said ask, the Kaaba is there. It's not in Lens, it's not in Fordsburg. It is there, you are there. Ask for whatever you want and surely you will get it. One, Maulana said that while you're on journey, you know, you people look very serious, brothers. Let me say to you, very serious Hajis, man. When you're on a journey, read your salah. I just want to say to you on a lighter side. 3-4 friends, they were traveling to Durban. Now you find in the 3-4 friends, 2 are Paban Namazis. And the 2, they sometimes, you know, for, Maghrib and Isha, they read. So they don't read all their Namazes, to, right? So now while they get to Durban, they are tired. But the 2 brothers who are Paban, they say, no. We're going to Brickfield Road. We're going to read our Salah with Jamaat. So the other 2 say, guys, man, help us. Man. We're also hungry and we're tired. They say, no, first Salah. Then we will do other things. Okay, fine. They went for Salah. And they read the Salah. And immediately after that, the Maulana stood up and he was busy. Every day in some masjids, they read a hadith. They read a 1-minute madrasa. They give some advice. So that day, the Maulana was speaking about Musafir Salah. And what he spoke about, that when you're a Musafir, now you must remember, out of the 4 that went, 2 are tired and 2 are very eager. They want to read their namaz on time. They are punctual. So the 2 very tired also, they had to read namaz. But they were tired, half sleepy, half tired. And the imam started saying that, you know what? When you Musafir, Dhuhr, Asr and Isha is half. Okay? Remember what the Maulana said, that Dhuhr, Asr and Isha is half. So fine, okay, they read the namaz, they went to the hotel, they slept everything, they read. The next morning, they got these 2 guys up, they read Fajr. When it came to Zohar, they didn't read. When it came to Asr, they said, no, we don't want to read. Now, they read Maghrib namaz, and they sitting in namaz, and they said, but guys, why didn't you read Zohar and Asr? He said, no, the Maulana said it's maaf. But it's not maaf, it's half. So when you tired, that half become maaf. So don't be tired. Read your salah. And another one about, I want to say this, we say every year to the brothers and sisters. Some brothers, I don't know, Maulana, you need to pick up from this and discuss it. A lot of brothers, they say to us, Karisab, you know, when you're doing the program, you're the director, you must tell the ladies they mustn't go shopping. I say, why must I do your job? You must tell your wife not to do shopping. Let me give her my size. This is the size of the kurta I wear. So please do the shopping. You understand? So you must do it. And the third one I want to say is, I want to say to you a true story. And I want to tell you, when you are connected to the Quran, a lot of people ask this question, when you connected to your salah, you look younger. You connected to the Quran, you look healthier. One day, Brother Hassan Pandey from Al Anwar told us this inspiring Al Anwar Express. He gave us this inspiring experience that they had. And listen to this. There were 2 sisters from Cape Town who were hafizas. Alhamdulillah, they were hafizas of the Quran. And a hafiz, you ask a hafiz, the Quran that he became a Hafiz al-Quran in, or a Hafizah, that Quran is very valuable to that person. Because where the Ustad ticked, where you made a mistake, or they made a cross, or there's a mutashabiha, there are 2 words of the same in another para is written. So that Quran is very valuable to you, but to somebody else it may not be. So these 2 sisters, they got married and they went for Hajj. When they went for Hajj, they went to Madinatul Munawwara. They had their Qurans. And now they are departing from Madinatul Munawwara. They're going to Makkah Mu'azzama. And the 2 sisters, they got onto the bus. The 1 sister had a Quran. She told her husband, put my Quran on the dashboard of the bus.
remember, you live in Madinatul Munawwara, you're in Ihram, then sometimes you are tired. They got to Makkah, they got to the Muassasa, they got to their hotel. And when they got to the hotel, they settled everything. And after a few hours, this sister remembered, asked her husband, did you take my Quran? He says, no. Now she is pareshan. She is disturbed. She started crying, my Quran. They went to the agent. The agent tried to track the bus. All that was done. But they could not get that Quran. And this sister, this Hafiza, all the days that she never had the Quran, she was crying. She wasn't eating. She was depressed. Her Quran is gone. The sister says, I will give you my Quran. No, it's not that. It is the Quran that I became a Hafiza with. That is what I want. Days pass in Makkah. She's depressed. She doesn't even eat. She doesn't even laugh. She missed her Quran. She lost her Quran. They've tried. The bus has left them in Makkah. That bus went to Jeddah. From Jeddah, it went to Riyadh. It went to so many other places. Where are you going to now find that Quran? This sister said, no, my Quran. Now they move from Makkah to Aziziyah. Every bus that was the same color the husband used to look out for. He says that one night, the husband and some friends in Aziziyah, they were walking. And on a side street, they seen this bus passing. And he looked at this bus and he says that this is the same color bus that we came from Madinatul Munawwara. He started running behind it and he got to the bus. Wallahi, on the dashboard, he found the Quran. When you link to the Quran, that Quran will come back to you. You link to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then what other link do we need? The best link is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are going to such a place. There are so many people in the world who've got all the resources. They've got everything, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not called them. They haven't. There are people that went to Jeddah and got back again. So this journey, from the Islamic aspect, from the physical aspect, from the medical aspect, we need to prepare for this once in a lifetime journey. Now what we hear nowadays is, you know what? No, I went for Hajj 25 years ago, but that Hajj wasn't too good. I will make another one to cement it and make it better. So I asked the brother, you read Fajr this morning? He says, yes. Did you cement it again? Did you read it again? He says, no. So why only Hajj you want to cement? Friends, let me say to you, we're preparing for Hajj. This is one of the pillars of our deen. There are so many people that crave to just see the rosa and the green dome of Masjid al-Nabawi. There are people who wish just to see the Kaabatullah. And what happened to many of us when that wish is fulfilled? When we go there and we bring back so many memories of what memories we bring. We don't say that I have seen the place where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had slept when he went for Mi'raj. Where the house of Hani is, I found out and I can tell you that we come back. But you know that watch that I bought, that black one that I bought it with this Haji bin of mine. Where we bought it in Jeddah, this is what we bring back. We're supposed to be bringing back the sunnah of Rasulullah alayhi salam. We're supposed to bring the farais into our lives. But this is what we bring back. You know that ice cream we used to eat? Ah, you know what? This is my Haji Ben. Then we drop all our guards also. Then the Haji Ben forgets the burqa and everything. Now we are Haji Bai and the Haji Ben. All the guards are dropped. Is that what we want to do on this journey? Friends, we're going to have questions and answers. We've got Shaheen back here. Yeah? We've got Maulana Habib Bobat. Why are you walking out? They're going to ask you some other questions. We're going to take about another 5 questions only. Then we're going to leave it for you to enjoy. I see many of the agents, they've got khajur, they got zamzam and some very important sweets and all that. So we want you to also enjoy all of those. So let's take 5 more questions. We have a first question there from, before I look, I can say it's Ibrahim Bhai.
Jazakallah Karisab. Just one question to Brother Shaheen. You know, when we applied in 2012, it did not ask us which year you want to go. It just put us on the list. So was there a request that you should specify which year you would like to go?
On the application system, when you apply, the default year is the year that is actually reflected on the system. But if you drop down on that default, there's a tremendous number of options that is available to you. You know, this is what we find, unfortunately, with our applicants. We apply, we put in whatever information we need to apply, and we fail to read the fine print. We also fail to read the, you know, questions or the frequently asked questions on the application system. And all the answers are there. But depending on your date and time, if you applied in anywhere after the 12th of September, then you would not have been accredited last year. Then, inshallah, you should be in the queue for this year. Jazakallah khair. You can actually, you can actually see where you are positioned in the queue on the current application list that is out at the moment. The lady in the front here had a question. Please, Muhammad.
May I ask, Ibrahim, by what date did you apply?
Then you, then you are in the queue.
I will give you my kurta size. Eh? I will give it to you.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
I wanted to know, with the point system, it's supposed to be increasing or decreasing. Me, my mom, and my dad, we applied 2014 October. And from 2014 up until 2015, it was 60 points. And 1 week back, I checked, and it dropped down to 40 points.
Okay, you need to double check that with the office because there's obviously a reason for that process. Again, on the frequently asked questions sector of the registration system, you'll see there's a segment, I think it's item number 13 or 14, which basically gives you the way points are calculated. Now, when there is a combination of first-time pilgrims and repeat pilgrims in the application, then you will be averaged out. So let's hypothetically say we have 2 first-time pilgrims, each getting 100 points. And we have 2 repeat pilgrims who have got 60 points each. So that's 200 plus 120 points is 320. Divide that by 4 people will give you the average in the queue. And that's basically how the system operates and how the system has been designed in that regard.
So are we then saying that you're going to finish all the 2009 up until 2012?
No. What we're saying is anybody with 100 points on date and time priority is eligible for accreditation depending on the number of visas that we've received. So if you want to have 100 points, you and your husband have never been, then you need to de-link from your parents who have made Hajj before in order for you to be queued separately from them. So the repeat pilgrim will have the lesser points and the first-time pilgrims will have 100 points. Okay, thank
May
you.
May I just request the brothers who are standing at the back, the agents who are interacting with one another, please give us another 15 minutes. We want your silence, please. We need your cooperation. Maulana Abdurrahman, we need your cooperation for the next few minutes. Give us, let us finish the session. We're going to have a vote of thanks, then we're going to have a dua. So please, let us observe silence. Up to now, you Hujjaj have behaved very well. The agents also. So just a few minutes, and then we will, inshallah, conclude.
I think, Akari, I don't see any more hands, so maybe after that question we can look at it.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. Salam.
I got a question for our panel. Last year there was a gentleman that we worked together, and I don't know how did he get accredited, but 3 weeks before Hajj, he went for Hajj, and he never ever applied in his life. How does it work?
Well, let me answer that very carefully. SAUQ is responsible for a quota that is basically handed down by the Ministry of Hajj, and that is 2,000. In my car, I've got the document, a copy of the document that we signed with the Ministry of Hajj, which will prove that we received 2,000 visas. That is what we work with. Now, the embassy in Pretoria has what they call a courtesy visa allocation for themselves. And they have absolutely no responsibility to Sauk insofar as that courtesy visa allocation is concerned. They can give that visas to whomever they please. You will find that there are ulama that get every year, that go every year, and there are certain business people or there are certain political affiliated people that go every year. That is outside of the confines and the boundaries of this program. Please understand that. The embassy has a right and they can do with it what they please. They don't have to answer to us because they answer to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs inside Saudi Arabia. I hope that's answered the question. Thank you.
Any other questions? Sisters? Normally the sisters come with a notebook and they write and they ask questions. Not the men, because the husband told her, you don't forget what I told you to ask. Is there any other questions? Last one. There's the last one. Let's take that last one and then we're going to ask Maulana Muhammad Vaid. Yeah, okay, last one.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Every year when it's a Hajj awareness, I always get on my cell phone. I want to know why didn't they send it out this year? And just luckily that I listened to Radio Islam, I had to get out so quickly and take two taxis to come here.
Ma'am, the cell phone SMSs did go out. I'd like you to please, in the front on the left-hand side, Haji, I've got 4,000 cell phone numbers on my computer that I can show you went out. You see that table on the left there? Can you please just go to them and give them your cell number so that we can check and verify after this, inshallah?
This Haji didn't get it, nor did I.
Can you please? Yes, 15% of our list of our 4,000 people did not get it. And email addresses, wherever we had email addresses, it was sent to those email addresses. So all I'm asking you to do is, again, and I reiterated this earlier in our talk.
Unfortunately, I wasn't here earlier. I came here about an hour ago. Like I said, I listened to Radio Islam.
Alhamdulillah.
Got dressed quickly and to take two taxis in to come to
Allah
here.
Reward you, Haji. I apologize if you didn't get it, but I can guarantee you that we sent out to the 4,000 people on our list. Who here received an SMS for your Hajj Awareness Day?
See? It's a lot that didn't get it.
15%, which is 535 people that unfortunately either had their numbers changed or something had gone wrong.
But our number's still the same.
Ma'am, I can check it on the system. That's not a problem. Hence, I tell you, please give your number to the people at the desk. And if it is not correct, then we will rectify it. But it helps us to verify. Thank you, sister.
Jazakallah. Anybody who hasn't got a message from Sahuk and who's on the queuing system, please just give your telephone number, your ID cell number, and your email address to the help desk. Inshallah, we will look at it and we will make sure that we will see to the system. I'm going to call upon Maulana Muhammad Vaid to come upon.
Maaf Kari, before you do that, I'd just like to appeal to everybody here. And everybody that you do know that may have applied. It costs you nothing to get onto our system using your ID number and the PIN number that has been provided to you. Go on there and check that your details on screen is correct. If your details are not correct, please get in touch with any one of the three SAUK offices countrywide and give them the information that needs to be changed. I implore you to do that because remember, we sit with a database of 65,000 people at the moment. We cannot phone every single one of you. We cannot check with every single one of you. Again, our system requires that you take some responsibility as well. You know, we have situations and queries where a brother comes and says, but you people have cancelled my accreditation on my application. Why didn't you do that? Again, brother, if you did not notify us of the changes of your details, then how is it that we're going to know that? So please, let us be fair to one another. Let us understand that we must work hand in hand in order to make this a pleasurable journey going forward, inshallah. Jazakallah khairan.
Jazakallah khairul jazah. Let me call upon a sister that needs no introduction. She's going to talk on behalf of the travel fraternity. And brothers, can we just have a little silence? I'm going to call upon Sister Fazila Malik to come and speak to us on behalf of the travel facility.
Fraternity.
Fraternity, sorry, not facility.
Praise be to Allah and salutation to our Nabi Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Respected ulama, brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Fazila Malik, who represents the travel fraternity. I'm sure you heard with all our speakers all about Hajj. Just need to put into light that the travel fraternity is the person that gets your actual visa authenticated and for you to travel. Yet our SAUK has our quota, but that is obviously your visa can only be concluded if you follow the following sequence. Subject to all Hajis this year, inshallah, will choose the travel fraternity, but can only give you the visa while or when you do conclude with your contracts on timeously given for by SAUK. Meaning, once you get accredited, there's a time frame given by SAUK to conclude with your travel fraternity, contracting with them, and then only we can complete your contracts in the kingdom via the contracts you have done. Brothers and sisters, please make and ensure that this time frame to be prompted, or else your visa will be delayed. Meaning that when we travel fraternity, we now linked onto the computerized system, none other than before going to the kingdom and doing the contracts physically and getting barcodes. We can complete this if everybody gives us a time frame. I need to emphasize that every Haji, before you sign your contract, as members of SAUK has also said this, that make and ensure that you read your contracts with your hotel accommodations, Medina, Mecca, transportation, and obviously your tanazzul taxes and your aziziyah. Starting off when you arrive, there will be facilities landing into Jeddah, where most of us travel fraternity may have Jeddah, may have Medina. The convenience of SAUK explaining about landing into Medina is one good a convenience that you land and obviously your journey does not become long. That is also obviously subject to the airline prices, what one could afford. Obviously, landing into Jeddah is a cheaper price. Landing into Medina is a higher price. So subject to your affordability, one should look at that. When you get received into Jeddah, SAUK will be receiving you due to the fact that they only have the security cards to enter Jeddah. So don't expect a travel agent to be there due to security reasons. Yes, we will receive you. We will advise SAUK as well prior to your landing to make it convenient due to the procedures of the Hajj Ministry. Once you arrive in Medina, we will be receiving you on the first point in Medina to expect you people and take you to the hotels. And thereafter, from that point, the entire travel fraternity will be taking care of you. I must emphasize when it comes to buses, yes, our colleague in SAUK told you about that. We were at one stage told about the buses via our protocol, SAUK, yet now we can do the convenience of the buses by upgrading it, and this you could speak to your travel fraternity. If you feel you need this kind of bus, mention it to them for your convenience, because there are different types of buses with different various companies as well. When it comes to 5 days, the Mashayar, Hajis that's going to be traveling this year, yes, we do have the special and the non-special. As our president said earlier, that looking at the prices is going to be ridiculous this year. Hajj is Hajj, where our forefathers and our Sahabas did, and if we go as per ulamas, what we say, simplicity of Hajj, comparison to the old years, Hajj is gone very easy. When we say non-special, you're still being in the wukuf or Arafat, and you are going to comply with your rules, and you will be benefiting your Hajj on those days. Again, I say, and I reiterate, that there are four kinds of services when it comes to your 5 days of Hajj. There is A+, B+, and C+ only. So if you feel you need to ask your Haji, your operator, if you need to go to a better facility, consider the price and see if you can afford it, you may do that. As far as the Muassasa is concerned, Sauk will be there as well when you arrive, be it in Medina or Mecca. But the agent take complete control as far as your passports are concerned. Meaning, once you arrive in Jeddah, your passports will be collected by the ministry, and Sahuk will be liaising that with you and putting it into the respective buses to ensure that that passport is going with you, whether it's from Medina, Mecca, or Jeddah. That all liaising is done all by the travel fraternity. All I emphasize, and I expect all Hajis to cooperate. And as our previous speaker said, if you come in with the cooperation, you could have a successful Hajj, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Jazakallah khairul jaza. Yes, very important is that we need the travel fraternity, and they are the very important aspect of this journey of Hajj. And as Sister Fazila has said, that you need to prepare, you need to get your documents, your contracts signed. And when you take your contract, you need to read it. Don't tell your wife to read it only, you need to read it, you need to understand it. And then sometimes what happens is that you know that it is half board. Now you don't know what is half board, right? You never traveled. Now you don't know that there's only breakfast in there. Now, but you tell your wife, but didn't I tell you to read the contract properly? But she didn't even know about it. Now you want to start shouting her. Because now it's half board. It's only breakfast, bed and breakfast, BB. So you need to do this homework. Sit down, talk with the agent, talk with the people that are advising you. Do it properly. But very important, let me say to you, as much as you're going to read many, many kitabs, you can read many kitabs. I know of people that read kitabs, they make so many notes, and they've got books and books they've read, and they make notes. But remember, that is practical, is the most important one. Theory, Mullah Ali Qari was a man who wrote the book on Hajj. He wrote the Arkan of Hajj. This is how you must make Hajj. He taught it to his students. But when he went to Makkatul Mukarrama, when he stood by the Kaabatullah and where Hajar Aswad is, he started making tawaf. He's going on to the left. You start going right. He went left. A young lad got him by his hand and said, "Ya Akhi, if you don't know how to make Hajj, read the book of Mullah Ali Qari." He was the author of it. So read the books. You're going to read so many books, you're going to be confused also. Let me say to you, like for example, there are so many words that you're going to hear today. You're going to ask, what is manasik? What is mashair? And what is, you're going to read about it. Some people, ignorant people that went for Umrah, they asked the Maulana, where are we going to buy Umrah from? The Umrah is not you're going to buy, is what you're going to do. The tawaf of the Kaabatullah, going on to Safa Sa'i, that is part of Umrah. Then you're going to go for Hajj. I'm going to call upon Brother Maulana Muhammad Vaid to come and do a vote of thanks, and then inshallah, the humble servant will conclude with a dua.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulil kareem. Alhamdulillah, my task is quite standard and formal. But prior to that, I would just like to elucidate on a few points. One is to understand what is the object and the purpose of SAUK. The South African Hajj and Umrah Council is basically a body to facilitate processes. On behalf of the Hajj Ministry
and in conjunction with the Department of Foreign Affairs, now known as DIRCO, that is the Department of International Relations and Cooperation, that is your body in South Africa. Many questions come about that SAUK needs to be responsible for other issues as well. So I think it is important for us to understand SAUK's role in perspective. And having said that, SAUK utilizes, in putting this process in place, the technology that is at our hands. And we have to understand and know very well that technology fails everybody, and human error also is no excuse. So when there is any issue or any problem or any query, in a considerate, honorable manner, let us address it in the necessary channels that are provided. That is when we will progress all together holistically, and Hajj will become a memorable journey for each and every person. Furthermore to that, I know today much information has been disseminated, every one of which is important. But if all of that is forgotten, processes, the masail, knowing what to do, what is expected from us, what is going to happen at which juncture, all of that will be fall into place. But we should not remove our eye from the target and the bullseye, and that is, what am I going for? From today already, we need to understand what is our honor. What is the status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us? That we are going to be the guests of Allah. We are going to be those that are going to be presenting ourselves in the court of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are not anymore any ordinary person and ummati that is walking the face of this earth. We are going to be placed on the mashair and the places of Hajj as ambassadors on behalf of the ummah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And most important, that from today, what has to take place is preparation, 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 and preparation. This cannot be overemphasized. The physical preparation, the mental preparation, and most importantly, the spiritual preparation that is required. Spiritual preparation does not only refer to us knowing the Messiah and what has to be done at every juncture, but the spiritual preparation of linking ourselves with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understanding this mammoth journey that we're going to undertake, so inshallah we can return with more than a handful of goodness and prosperity. And we make dua that Allah grants us all a Hajj Maqbool, Hajj Mabroor. As far as the task that I have been given, that is the vote of thanks. First and foremost, all gratitude is to all of you that have presented yourselves. There is no SAUK, there is no Hajj operators, there is no Hajj without a Haji. All of you that have come in that enthusiasm that Allah is going to present us this opportunity of placing ourselves before Him, that alone is graciousness that we are showing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have presented yourself here today. SAUK is very grateful to you that you have adjusted your schedules, some at extremely short notices. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from you and remember us also in your pious du'as. Furthermore to that, who have made this venue possible, Image Lifestyle, par excellence for the recordings and the sound system, Radio Islam being the media partner in broadcasting the Hajj Awareness Day, and all the Hajj agents, all the tour agents, operators, Hajj operators that have made themselves available to present the different packages that they will be able to showcase to you, you will be able to view after the program. And lastly, all the volunteers that have made this program a success, and more so those that have volunteered on behalf of SAUK to the mission and making all our programs a success. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be your reward. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take you from strength to strength. Jazakum Allahu khairan.
Jazakallah Maulana, I thank you once again, and I thank all the members. Let us read Durood Sharif first. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina wa Mawlana Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam. Hayyina Rabbana bis salam. Wadakhilna dana salam. Tabarakta Rabbana wa ta'alayta ya dal jalali wal ikram. Allahumma thabbitna ala al-iman. ومتنا على الإيمان وحشنا يوم القيامة مع الإيمان
بحرمة القرآن وبحرمة النبي آخر الزمان. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان وجعلنا من الراشدين وجعلنا من المتقين وجعلنا من الصالحين. اللهم نور قلوبنا بالقرآن وزين أخلاقنا بالقرآن ونجنا من النار بالقرآن وادخلنا الجنة بالقرآن. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وقنا عذاب القبر وقنا عذاب الحشر وقنا عذاب الفخر وقنا عذاب الدين واحشرنا يوم القيامة مع المتقين مع الأبرار. يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. اللهم ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين. اللهم ارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. Yeah, let's get up here.